deathbed, CERN, mass electromagnetic influx, WikiLeaks infiltrated, financial collapse, insider elections, globalists, nationalists, Trump versus Hillary, WagDog, media manipulation, mind control, matrix, latest cutting edge news, leak project.
Hey guys, what is going on? It's Jay Campbell from TRT Revolution and the author of the definitive TRT manual. And I'm joined by my awesome friends, Rex Baer of the Leak Project, of course, is with us tonight. And we're joined by Tony Monticone, one of my good friends from Miami, Florida, who's been on the show a couple times now. And then we have a newbie contributor to the show tonight, but not a newbie to the Decoders of Truth at all. It's Troy Gothard. He is a super moderator for us. And Troy's an awesome dude. He's been watching all the Decoders of Truth podcasts. He's very, very aware, extremely knowledgeable, and we're awesome. We're extremely thankful to have him on the show tonight. So with that said, Troy, how are you, buddy?
I'm doing well, brother. Thanks for having me on.
Awesome, man. Well, we're glad to have you. So anyway, Rex has got a bunch of amazing topics we're going to discuss tonight. We're going to jump right into the show. We know there's a ton of people in the Decoders of Truth that are interested in watching this, so I'm going to go live probably in the next 10 minutes or so. But Rex, take it away, brother.
Great. You know, it's nice to speak with all of you guys. It's good to have a roundtable going on right now. And essentially what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn off my video so I can share the screens with you guys here. But I've got a whole bunch of data set up. I've got it all bullet pointed. We're going to go through this very fluently because we do have so many different topics that I want to discuss with you guys. So let's get started. First thing that I want to talk to you guys about is the debates that I watched all three of them. And I can't believe how well the Saturday Night Live skit was that Alec Baldwin played Trump. I mean, he played Trump better than Trump does. It's just amazing. And then you watch that third debate, and I almost thought that the same person that wrote the script for Saturday Night Live was the debate writer for Trump. I mean, and just his mannerisms and everything. But there's a lot more to the information we're going to bring out right now. But I did find it fascinating how first there's this scandal about how Hillary's using these ridiculous hand signals to persuade, you know, the debates and what they're doing. And then, well, all after that, they start talking about WikiLeaks, and the mainstream media starts talking about WikiLeaks. And one thing that Assange came out with before this WikiLeaks being blasted all over the internet is, I'm going to bring information out about Hillary that's going to take her down, essentially. And now I haven't heard really anything of Assange except for some cryptic stuff. And then you find out his mentor dies recently. This just happened a few days ago, Gavin MacFayden. And if you look at the Wikipedia website itself and just the stuff that they're talking about, it's all over the news, the media, it's in the social media. I think that WikiLeaks has been taken over. I think it's a part of the establishment. What are your guys' thoughts?
I have to agree. You know, Tony, I'm going to let Tony speak here and then obviously jump in, Troy, because Tony is a very big wiki guy and he's been reading all the stuff and he spends probably, you know, an hour a day going through the stuff, especially the new stuff that comes out. So he'll probably be able to add a lot more. But all I can go by, Rex, is, you know, back to what you're saying too with the Trump, you know, speechwriter, you know, writing for Alec Baldwin. I mean, I think at this point, all of us know that this is a giant three-card Monty game. You know, the elites, you know, there's obviously factions of elites, you know, some of them represent Hillary, some of them represent Trump. It's obvious. I at this point, you know, for any of us to sit here and think that whoever wins, there's going to be real change in America, I can't see it. What are your thoughts, Tony?
It's hard to say, man. Every minute, it seems like something, a different spin comes out. Everything is constantly changing. It's such a fluid environment. It's almost like you don't know what to believe anymore. It's just a level of craziness that I personally have never seen. I mean, I don't know. What are your guys' thoughts? Have you ever seen anything remotely close to what is taking place right now, especially when it comes to, you know, the politics in general, where you have?
No, it hadn't. You know, I'm 48. I'll be 49 next month. And one thing I've always followed pretty a lot is politics. And this cycle with the Rothschilds, you know, running the cabal and having their fingers entwined into the whole political process has been a real eye-opening experience, and especially to see this time around how they go about it. And this time they went about it using the superdelegates one way, messing with the DNC and Debbie Wasserman Schultz another way. So it's really cool to see it from an awakened point of view, how the cabal is being intertwined. However, it's a sensory overload, and we'll get into that, I'm sure.
Yeah,
let me jump in real quick, because when I first started talking about the elections and Trump on one side, Hillary on the other, I was thinking they were more working for the same team. Like they were actually talking behind the scenes and okay, you do this for me, I'll do this for you. You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. No, I'm not going to make presidency, but I don't want presidency. I just want these corporate gains. I want these businesses to excel. I want this type of advertising, these connections, etc. So I'll play the opposite. If you've seen the video footage before they went at it into the limelight, they were friends. They were always hanging out together. There's plenty of footage you can see where Trump would come out and say, oh, Hillary, she's amazing. I hang out with the Clintons all the time. They're just wonderful people. And now they won't even walk past each other after the debates. But maybe they're two different teams working for the same league. That's what I see it as now. And I do see there being a difference. If Hillary makes it in, I think it's going to be more of the same. It's going to be a continuation of the current administration.
Right.
If Trump makes it in, I do see it being more of a nationalist type environment or archetype, at least during his administration. Now, I'm not voting for either of them. Yeah. I think that there's plenty of other candidates out there that could do a much better job. But hey, you know, I mean, Trump does have a whole bunch of businesses, business savvy, etc. And yeah. Wow, that'd be unbelievable. That would be a very interesting time. But my point is, what'd you say?
Only if I'm your vice presidential running mate.
Hello, hello. Hey, you have seen the new Kiefer Sutherland TV series out there, Designated Survivor.
I haven't seen that. I've seen the commercials for it, but I haven't seen the episode.
Well, if you guys believe in the pre-programming, TV shows, media, et cetera, often portrays, in Designated Survivor series, the entire cabinet gets wiped out. I mean, the entire administration, except for two people, are left over. And that's why Kiefer Sutherland gets into the presidency, because everybody else got taken out. And then there's this, you know, it's, I'm on like episode four or something like that. But it is interesting to see a lot of the TV shows out there in media that's portraying the downfall of Western civilization, like White House down, London down.
Well, I mean, if you remember on the last podcast, you know, you intimated about, you know, China becoming the next big superpower and how Hollywood is already engineering that. So I think that slowly but surely the United States is going to lose its quote unquote luster as the world's preeminent superpower.
I think that it's heading there already. And I think that's part in place of what we're seeing going on behind the scenes, especially. I mean, if you look at the different trade pacts that are out there, you have the five, what makes up BRICS, which is Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Those have been the world's leading emerging markets, okay? They have their trade pact in plan, which is BRICS, obviously. Those five countries alone make up for 30% of the GDP. China is so far superior, especially from a financial standpoint. The United States will never, ever be able to catch back up. And then you look at Russia and where they're at, just from a military standpoint. I mean, people are underestimating what their nuclear program is at right now. Some people believe it's stronger than what we have, okay? So there's a lot going on just in that alone. I mean, if you have-
Go ahead, Rex.
No, I mean, when you're done, I'll jump in, Tony. I just wanted to bring up the new weapon systems. I was thinking about the nuclear stuff today, and I did some research into the electromagnetic weapons that they're working on right now. And we'll get into this in a minute, but they've got some new weapon technologies that are so far above and beyond nuclear stuff that I think that's quite primitive. But please finish what you're going
to
say.
No, it is. You're absolutely right. I mean, in EMF, some of what you're going to allude to, I mean, they can fry the electrical components of anything. So even if you have a nuke, if you can, you know, fry, or if you have planes flying over that are going to come to war, you can fry everything from the machine without even having to, you know, to fire anything off at somebody. I mean, that level of warfare, I mean, wow, can you even imagine what that brings to the table? I mean, it's just a whole nother element. So there's so many variables here, but you know, if you look at the big picture, I'm still, again, you know, I say one thing and I think one thing, and then the next minute I see something else, and it's like, what's going on? But yesterday, I don't know if you guys heard or not, but they, you know, it got leaked that, you know, this whole tax plan with, you know, with Hillary Clinton, she has a tax cut for overseas corporations, tax slash that been failed to be, you know, brought up or spoken about during this election. So it goes against everything that is being preached that, oh, this is a good deal for the rich. No, I mean, for the poor, that we're going to tax the rich. They're not really taxing the elites. That's the difference. The people that are going to be, the top 5%ers might be paying, very well be paying a lot more in taxes. And, you know, obviously when you start looking into the death tax and all the implications that it has on the estate tax, I mean, there's huge implications there that she wants to implement. But really what it's doing is for the top 0.001%ers that are out there, the global elite, this little tax provision that she does absolutely benefits these businesses and the banks. And it sets up for, if indeed her true idea is this global hemisphere where you have, you know, basically any corporation can pick up, move to any country within the trade pact, set up shop, pay them whatever they want, You know, these people, they can bring them from Singapore, pay them 2 cents an hour, and we can't see anything. And people think that the lower class and the middle class are going to get better from this. There's nothing good that comes from this.
There is no middle class in the United States.
But all this does to me is just prove more suppression, not just from the middle and lower class. It's also weakening even the upper class. Okay. So that it's just empowering even more so the elite. I mean, that's the way I'm taking so far.
You're going to talk about the six companies that own all the media, correct?
Right. And what you're saying, Tony, as far as these new laws and bills and tax breaks, et cetera, I mean, it's just more of the same. And it's going to go on either way. This kind of stuff people don't really care about. You'll hear them say that they do, but is it really going to change the elections? No, absolutely not. I mean, with as much stuff that's already out there to sway somebody, if they don't care after they look at all that and they just continue to vote and say, oh, well, I've got to be a part of this system anyways. Otherwise, I don't have a right to speak my mind if I don't vote. I think that's one of the most interesting mindsets. I don't want to talk down to that, but I do see that as kind of a primitive way to look at things. If you're voting for a corrupt system just because you think one person is the lesser of two evils, hey, that's totally fine. Or maybe you can go out and look for other opportunities, like being that person that you would vote for, you know, be that change. But essentially, I think that's really what it's going to take to change the system is enough people are going to have to say, look, I've had enough. You're giving me two options. I'm not going to choose either of these options. I'm going to make my own option. I mean, this is just retarded. People live in this. People are so brainwashed because of the programming that's out there. For example, what we're talking about right now, there's six corporations that control over 90% of the media. And who controls that media? Well, offshore factions, very rich, intelligent people that want to persuade you in certain ways for their best interests. Now, there's a lot of offshore factions as well. There's a lot of alphabet agencies that are orchestrated within these programming institutions. And you look at these six organizations right here, the top six organizations that control over 90% of the media. You've got Comcast, the Walt Disney Channel, or not the Walt Disney Channel, the Walt Disney Company, 21st Century Fox, Time Warner, CBS Corporation, and Viacom. Look at the billions and billions and billions of dollars that they have access to and the funds that they're bringing in. Now, if you don't think, I mean, look at the names here. There's one thing that I want to bring up to you guys. Think about this for a minute. ABC, CBS, NBC, Google changed their name to Alphabet.
Right. Now,
what does that mean to you guys? What's the first thing that comes to your mind? Alphabet agency? Why do all these companies have specific alphabet-like names? Is there something subliminal to that? Is there something more to that? Did one institution pick CBS and these other guys over there like, well, hey, that's working for them, so I'm going to pick ABC. Maybe. Now, once you find out that these six corporations control over 90% of the media, and then you've got a debate where the moderator comes out and says, well, what about WikiLeaks when they said this? You can darn well be certain that WikiLeaks is going to be in on it to that level. Now, could the moderator, could the people that are controlling WikiLeaks be in on the system now? Could they be underneath the umbrella of the execs or somebody in specific within these six institutions? I think so. Now, can I prove that without a shadow of a doubt? No, absolutely not. But this is more wag the dog, in my opinion. Kind of like when Trump, people are going, oh my gosh, man, Trump isn't putting any money out there in the media. And look at all this coverage and everybody loves him. Well, the media was giving him the coverage. They were giving him free coverage by exposing that. And they had an agenda. They always do. So if you really think that they tell you something on the media about WikiLeaks, then you do some more research into it, you might find out that rabbit hole is a lot deeper than you think. Now, that brings me to the next level of the conversation. And this is some pretty deep stuff right now. If you type into Google, tilt of sun traced to undiscovered planet, there are multiple websites, mainstream news articles, channels, and institutions that are talking about this, like Caltech. Now, if you go to Space Daily, that is not a conspiracy website. Curious tilt of the sun traced to undiscovered planet. If you want to go to Astronomy Now online, hunt for Planet 9 reveals extremely distant solar system objects. There's a lot of information out there now pointing to some very serious changes around not only our planet here at home, but also the objects in our solar system due to possibly what could be a ginormous planet. Now, let's think about this for a second. You guys have heard of Mr. Brown, astronomer Brown. He's the guy that downgraded Pluto in 2006. He's also one of the same key players that's saying Planet 9 is here and it's causing mass havoc to the solar system. So could there be something more to it? Could they have downgraded Pluto in order to, when they start talking about this extra planet causing damage, they can't leak it to Planet 10 or Planet X to keep down mass hysteria? Could this be legit, or could this be more wag the dog election stuff?
Well, I mean, again, if we're going to go by Gerald Clark or Zechariah Sitchin or, you know, Harrington and all these people that decoded this quote unquote inbound planet and body, you know, we've got Terrell, there's all these guys out there that are highly intelligent people who have, you know, analyzed reams of data who've said that there is an inbound, you know, incoming body. So, you know, the only other thing I'll bring up, Rex, is, you know, first off, we have Caltech and NASA now admitting that Planet Nine exists, right? So whether Planet Nine is
nibbling, you know, who influences Caltech big time?
Who does? Is that, is
who does? Yeah.
Who influences Caltech?
Yeah.
Specifically, I don't know.
Well, there's a lot of evidence pointing to the Tavistock Institute being heavily involved.
Oh, okay. I want you to get there. Let me just make one point. It's all a psyop in some capacity. But the only other point I wanted to say, and I know we've all talked about this, but, you know, Obama just approved last week the space weather events, right?
Absolutely.
The official White House. Right. So my thoughts are that Nibiru or Planet Nine or whatever we want to call it, Wormwood, you know, the blue kachina, the red kachina, whatever, there's something is coming. I don't know if it's 6 months out, 6 years out, 3 years out, 2 years out, whatever. But if it's not, it's one or the other. If it's not coming, then they're going to engineer or orchestrate a psyop, which could be Project Bluebeam. It could be something along those lines, because why are they creating these giant governmental quasi or, you know, legislative acts to say that space weather events are coming if they're not designing to have space weather events or whatever that entails?
I get a kick out of all the speculation, you know, even us right here, right now. I got to be honest. It's the only way I know how to be. Have been written about since 450,000 years that we know of, at least. Right. You've got murals, crop circles, writings. The most intelligent minds that we know of have written about this. Yep. They've deciphered the writings, which all say, you will not know. We are not to know. And that's where I get the kick out of all this, because at the end of the day, it's in the writings. We're not supposed to know until it's too late.
I mean, there's a few writings that say that, if you're a religious person, especially. But there's also plenty of people that are very intelligent that are 100% convinced that things are going to happen at specific times. And you said there's some very intelligent people that talk about Nibiru. And there's some incredibly intelligent people with IQs far above and beyond what mine is. There's
and
also some
part of it. That's where the resonation comes in.
There's, you know, so it really, in the world that we live in, man, and with as much information that's out there, and with as many times we've been lied to, and with the information we have access to, you can find the opposite of everything.
Yeah, absolutely.
You can and say that organic apples are bad for you because there might be some type of shit on there from a manure that wasn't, you know, that wasn't this like chemically induced specific petro type chemical. So you'd be better off spraying radon it, so you wouldn't have to be worrying about getting something from bird poop or something, because it protects you.
Rex, can I get a 5-marisol from you real quick? I'm counting.
Good point. Touche.
So what we rely on as individuals is what resonates with us. And that is the creator of all's gift to all of us. And that's what pissed off Enlil so much. We have discernment. And when you have that discernment from the creator of all, that is your guide. And I'm learning how to use that. And it led me to y'all. People ask us in the Decoders of Truth page, who's your favorite researcher? And if you do not put you as an individual first, then why are you there? You led you to that. So I am my favorite researcher, first and foremost. It led me to all of you and everything that I'm finding out on a daily basis. And I say that with the utmost humility. We are of the creator of all. And that's, again, what ticked off Enlil so bad. I like that. I rely on that.
Well said, dude. Tony.
Very well said.
What are your thoughts, Tony?
No, I think that was great. What he just said is very well said. You know, there is no absolutes. I mean, that's what we should, you know, that's an obvious thing. We all have to use our intuition. I think that has led us all to this point. I think all of our spidey senses, for lack of a better term, have been going off lately. And current events right now, I think more than ever, I mean, all of these supposed, you know, all of us tin hat wearing fools out here with all of our conspiracy theories. I mean, what else we didn't mention here was a couple days ago on mainstream TV, on CBS, you know, the doctor's name.
The clown. I know what you're talking about.
Right. He's on CBS telling, you know, saying that we have, you know, HARP that's been around for decades. This is in the mainstream media. Now it's hidden. You don't hear it because obviously the election is what's getting all the news. But when would we ever hear something like that on mainstream media? I mean, where that's coming out. Then you have the release. And these aren't just, and again, like you were saying before, Rex, you know, some of this stuff, all the stuff I hear, this isn't just from some hokey, you know, websites that are coming out. These are, you know, mainstream, you know, media sites that are releasing some of this information, not the National Enquirer here. So now we're seeing this stuff. We're seeing highly intelligent scientists, people that are respected in their fields, highly respected in their fields. The Caltech researcher that you're referring to came out and said that there's a 0.00007% chance that that this is just an accident, that there's a formation of, or it's just some rock cluster that's out there in the middle of nowhere. So you're seeing a lot, you're hearing a lot more come forward. Even there's, I don't know if you guys caught it or not, but even Fox put something out a couple days ago where they found, I guess it was found in the 70s in Romania, a piece of metal. That they're saying it's there's no way possible that we could have, first of all, aluminum, I guess we started making aluminum only in the last 100 years. This piece of metal that they found is a combination of aluminum and some other metals that they say is impossible, that we don't have the technology to mold the, you know, to put these two, to put these metals together, that we, you know, so you're hearing a lot of stuff come out that has never been, you know, come out at this level. Now it's hidden again because you're distracted with everything else that's going on. But that, to me, that in and of itself is amazing.
When you have the proverbial Days of Our Lives playing out with the Anunnaki factions, we get that.
Right.
So Rex, so do you think then, back to what you were saying, do you think then that there's just all the information coming out right now, combined with the disinfo, it's just impossible for people to discern what's true and what's not?
No, not at all. And, you know, it's the age of Aquarius. That's why all this information is readily available, because this is literally, if you believe in these different transitions, right, as I certainly do, they're supposedly linked with the stars in conjunction as above, so below. The age of Aquarius is the information age. Therefore, all this information is readily available, and right, you guys can have access to it if you want to. I do think that discernment is very powerful. Now, when I brought up the very intelligent people on either side of the coin, there's people that are very intelligent on both sides the fence that truly are passionate about their beliefs, right, and they're willing to go to bat for that. So for me to go up there and be like, well, dude, you're full of it, man, and you work for the dark side or whatever, because they have a different belief than me, if that's truly their beliefs, I respect them for that. Now, yeah, if they're going to come after me, if they're going to come after my family, you know, I mean, don't tread on me, I won't tread on you. It's but if you're on that balance, if you are in tune with where you're supposed to be, it's just like the stars out there, they should all be aligned a certain way. And this whole Planet X thing, I do certainly believe there is a Planet X. I mean, there's over 1,200 of them right now that we can admit to. Do I think that it is identical to Nibiru that was discussed with Zachariah Sitchin and many others? Like, even Mauro Bellino does translations that correlate with the 3,600-year orbit of Nibiru. I'm still agnostic to that. And that's where my gut tells me to be. So, I am very in tune with myself. And people sometimes say, why are you so agnostic to things? Well, that's where I'm at in my life right now towards things. But there are certain things that I know for you know, you're not going to convince me that thimerosal is good for you. You're not going to convince me that putting squalene and certain adjuvants and glyphosate, certain derivatives of Roundup is good to inject into babies' bloodstreams at birth. You're not going to convince me of that. You're not going to convince me that it's a good idea to frack the entire country, build nuclear reactors next to fault lines, and just say, hey, man, we'll be okay. You know, I mean, it's good for 50 years. We will be around anyway. You know, I mean, you're not going to convince me of that kind of stuff. But when it comes to certain things like that I haven't touched, I haven't felt tangible evidence, you know, I mean, all this stuff that's out there in the news, people keep saying, oh, it's on the mainstream news now, even the mainstream news. And I've even done this before. So what? If it's in the mainstream news, that means it's probably bullshit. I mean, think about that for a minute. I mean, seriously, I used to be, and I still do this sometimes. I'm like, see, it's
100% control.
News, mom and dad. Hey, guys, check this out. This isn't even a conspiracy. I mean, I've even brought it up twice in this conversation that it's talked about in regular websites and regular newscasts. And the more I think about it, that is just a part of the system. Over 90% of the media is controlled by these six conglomerates. Right. And there's a few hundred executives that control these six corporations, combined with the stockholders and the people at the very top levels that control these big institutions. Like, Jay knows more about stocks than I do. I mean, if you want to talk about the stocks and the money funders, I mean, Jay knew that system to a T, and he won't even touch that anymore because he knows how corrupt and wicked and nasty it is. And he will sacrifice millions of dollars just to stay out of that system, because that's the beast hive system. And he's breaking free with these decoders. I mean, you don't make money doing these decoders of truth shows, Jay. I mean, this is all out of passion and love for what you do, man. And I certainly respect you for that. And you guys too aren't making any money doing this. I mean, we're driving together because we're truth seekers. We're looking for information. We're tired of being lied to. 90% of the media is completely controlled by the Borg. We will not assimilate. So we're joining forces together to wake people up. And it's amazing how many people are waking up. When I first started Leak Project about a year ago, I didn't know how powerful some of the information was going to be. And I don't think it's because of myself. I just think it's the collection of the people that are listening to the shows, the information we're talking about, the people that I'm interviewing, and everything combined. It just joins this. It's just synchronicity, man. It's harmony. It's amazing what's going on right now. We have an opportunity right now, every single one of us, to make a change. And whoever gets in office, I think there's things a lot more important right now than who's going to get in office. And I think there's things a lot more important right now than worrying about Planet X and Nibiru. There's stuff out there that we really need to be aware of. Otherwise, they're going to continue to just turn up the temperature just a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. And the frogs that are still in the water aren't going to have a chance to jump out anymore. They're going to be done. If there is a Nibiru that does a mass orbit every 3,600 years, and it's going to cause nuclear reactors to blow up. It's going to cause the poles to shift. It's going to cause all the satellites to collapse. Do you want to survive that anyway?
No, we've discussed this.
Hold on 1 second, because you brought up, that was really good, by the way. Let me give you a golf cup. Mm-hmm. That was really, really good. But let's stay where you're at right now. Let's talk about discernment and what resonates, because the reality of what you just said is all true, okay? If you are a Nibiru believer or you're a disbeliever, it doesn't matter. What you can control is what is in your life. You can't control Nibiru coming into our orbital passageway and turning everything upside down, killing 95% of the people, and the Georgia Guidestones are right. You can't think about that stuff. All you can do is live your life every day, being in service to others, using, Troy said, discernment, and not worrying about yesterday and thinking about tomorrow. It's all about what you do now, right? I mean, all of us watching this, and by the way, I'm live in the Decoders of Truth, and there's a bunch of people watching, but all we can control is what's in front of us, okay? We can't worry about Nibiru or about Trump or Hillary and the NWO and the globalists and, it's all fear porn, as like Rex very accurately pointed out. So there's no point in focusing on it. And guess what? If we do have a space weather event in 4 or 5 months from now, and things start getting weird, then maybe we could think about what's going to happen. But it doesn't matter, because even if it does happen, guess what? You're going to die and you're going to go on to your next incarnation, right?
So absolutely.
There's no reason to worry, man.
Well, and let me jump in real quick. People say, well, there's nothing I can do. Well, there is something you can do. I mean, look at what Elon Musk did. He started PayPal, or he helped start PayPal. He sold it, made billions of dollars, started a rocket company. Now he shoots rockets into space. Yep. I mean, you can do it. You've got the power. You've got three parts of your brain can all harmonize together, and you can be the change you want to see. You want to be a billionaire? Do it. You want to be a politician and change the system? Do it. You want to be a talk show host? Do it. I mean, whatever you feel passionate about. I mean, there's people that help thousands of people out of the kindness of their heart, like, for example, what happened on the East Coast with Hurricane Matthew. I've talked to people that were personally there helping others that were affected by that, whether you want to call it a harp hurricane or a natural disaster, whatever. So now, does that mean I don't believe in Planet X? Once again, no, I certainly believe there's a Planet X. Do I feel for sure that what's being talked about in the media about how it's twisting the sun and tilting all these planets and everything to be true? It could be. I don't know. But another thing that it could be is, could it be CERN? Well, people are like, wow, that's far out there, Rex. Well, it is far out there. But let me show you something here. I just found this out here today.
Good transition. So CERN's,
if you go to CERN's website, pulling together superconducting electromagnets, just right here, it's real simple. All the magnets on the LHC are electromagnets. The main dipoles generate powerful 8.3 Tesla magnetic fields, more than 100,000 times more powerful than the Earth's magnetic field. The electromagnetics use a current of 11,080 amperes to produce the field. Now, if you go into this amount, 100,000 times more powerful than the Earth's magnetic field, you not think that's going to have an effect on the magnetic field of the planet. Now, in 2013, I picked up this dandy little radiation detector watch. It's an MTM military grade watch. And the radiation levels right now are 0.13 microsieverts per hour. That is almost double what it used to be when I picked it up in 2013. And it's consistently increased. Now, in 2012, there was a change to the geomagnetic poles. And it said, if that happens, then there's going to be more radiation coming in from different stars and the sun, et cetera. Well, there's your answer. If you're feeling more heat on your skin, if you're feeling more intense, the reason the radiation levels have increased is because the electromagnetic atmosphere, the protective atmosphere, has changed. Could CERN be affecting this?
Absolutely.
Well, you tell me. I mean, it's right there. I mean, they're a lot smarter than me. But so look at this real quick.
So is it actually possible, and Tony, you can jump in here a second, but is it actually possible then that CERN, we hear all the conspiracy theory about CERN, but could it be possible that CERN is actually working in conjunction to, if Nibiru exists or Planet Nine or, again, whatever we want to call it, that they're actually working to throw off its orbital passage so that it moves out so far away that it doesn't destroy us? I mean, I guess it's possible, right?
That's what some of the channelers are saying, that there's other entities that are assisting us with Nibiru's approach. I step outside my comfort zone and try to rely on resonance.
It's definitely possible. Go ahead.
I want to just show you guys one more thing real quick, and then I'm going to let you take the mic, Tony, because this is in conjunction with what we're talking about. Now, if you look at how powerful, we were just getting 100,000 times more powerful than the Earth's magnetosphere. Right here, look at this. They're actually doing tests right now that are talked about in Los Alamos Laboratories that are running 100 Tesla. Now, what that means to you guys, okay, 100,000 times more powerful than the Earth's magnetic field is 8.3 Teslas.
Wow.
Well, they're doing experiments with 100 of them.
10 million.
And that's what they're telling us about. And this isn't even CERN. This is in Los Alamos, ladies and gentlemen. Wow. So if you don't think that there could be some type of, you know, some type of, I don't know, what's the word I'm looking for here? Transference of energy or geomagnetic pole shift, something just where things are going out of whack. If this one machine has enough power to emit 100,000 times the amount of the Earth's electronic magnetosphere, well, what do you think things are doing in Los Alamos?
They're clearly, with this kind of power, they're clearly able to control things. They're clearly able to shift things in certain directions, obviously. Go ahead, Tony.
That's a great find that Rex found. I was unaware of that, the power, the sheer power of from a magnetism standpoint. That's pretty fascinating. And yes, that logic would tell me that, hey, if we have something here on Earth that has the potential to have, you know, that much more of an impact, you know, from a magnetic standpoint, absolutely. I mean, logic tells me, hey, maybe we are the ones tinkering that is causing a shift or a decrease in our magnetism. I mean, it makes total sense. There's a great, actually, it's funny that you were bringing CERN up. Last night, there's on Netflix, you can find it. There's an interesting documentary that's out there. Obviously, it doesn't go into telling you the power of it necessarily, but it does show you it's pretty informative. I just saw it last night on Netflix, but it goes back to, you know, what we're all talking about here. I mean, there's so many different theories or possibilities that are out there. The believers in it, the people who don't believe in it, you do have to truly follow your intuition. You know, you kind of go back to saying about how you don't think that the grand scheme of things with what's going on in politics matters. I don't disagree with what you're saying, but I do have a little bit more of a different feeling. I do think what's going on with this election right now may have a dramatic impact on all of our futures going forward. I mean, I definitely, without a doubt, believe that right now you have more and more people waking up and are becoming aware because of questioning everything that's going on right now within politics. I don't think that we can be short-sighted either on that. And we don't know what is going to come from with everything that's going on. I mean, you know, if there's a war here with Russia, which everything kind of looks like it's pointed out, is it this info? You know, is it all a lie? Is it just a big grand scheme to make us believe one thing and something else happens? It's hard to say. I mean, that's never happened before. Anytime we've had conflict to get to this point before in the past, very few times has it been avoided. Even going back to the Cold War, I mean, this is, I would say that right now, you know, we've surpassed that level of where we were at. I mean, Gorbachev himself is coming out and saying it. So again, is it disinfo? What do you want to believe? It would be a crazy story with a bunch of actors going on right here if this is all, you know, just some made up ploy. So
it might be, unfortunately, as Rex said. I mean, this is so highly organized, it seems like, from a media standpoint. I mean, you know, look at the media, right? We've had all the, you know, if we go back a year, all the media has been aligned to support Hillary. You know, they did their, Rex, remember, they did the show in Hollywood, Madam Secretary, which was her story, literally, on ABC, right? It's Hillary's story. So they've been engineering what appears or seems to be like Hillary as the president, right? But now, as Rex has very accurately pointed out, with all the WikiLeaks stuff, maybe the PSYOP is actually to get Trump in. You know, again, if you do believe that they're both serving the same Illuminati hands, elites, rulers, archons, whatever, it does seem like that there's no change in the United States other than, as Rex said very accurately, the NWO globalists are Hillary, and the nationalists, which are probably still a faction of the NWO globalists, is Trump. But it's just so weird to me now because, like, everybody has thought that, oh, Hillary's going to win. You know, the polls show Hillary with a 12-point lead, blah, blah, blah. But wouldn't it be fascinating, you know, in its own self or its own right to see Trump win, at, you know, against all odds, quote, unquote?
Well, it would be. Just look at Brexit.
Go ahead.
Just look at Brexit. I mean, the polls were heavily opposed to that happening. And what happened? People woke up the next day and were in shock that Brexit happened. So who knows what's going on? But
well, let me ask you a question. Serious question.
You guys do know a bunch of the voting machines are actually owned by a corporation of Soros, right?
Yeah. So Rex, it's all absurd.
But we're going to vote, man. I know it's going to count.
Well, let me ask you all a question. Let's talk about the election just real quick. So
I love you, Hillary.
Whoever wins, so this is my take, and then I want you guys to go. Troy, you're first. So if Hillary wins, my opinion is that 40%, and it may be a lot higher, of course, because the media tells us that 40% of the public is for Trump. But if Hillary wins and we take the media's number, which is obviously probably underestimated, then we know that 40% of the United States does not have their mandate. So if you look at the states where that's a high, you know, a lot of people, and we all know that the number one thing that Hillary wants to do when she gets into office, which she's already closed, very openly admitted, is take away the Second Amendment, you know, the right to bear arms, and institute two liberal Supreme Court justices ratify them and then take away the guns. So the reality is there's a lot of states in the United States right now that will not allow that to happen. So my take is, and you guys pick this up, is if Hillary wins, we're on a slow death march to states seceding from the union and potentially, I don't know what else, maybe worse. If Trump wins, I see the inner cities of every major city in North America on fire. I see like the same shit that happened in LA.
Can't we all just get along?
During the Watts riots, you know, the inner cities will be rioting. Am I wrong? Do you guys disagree with me? If I am, that's fine. Tell me.
No, I tend to agree with that second part of what you said with regards to Trump. He has disenfranchised so many different demographics, unfortunately, on a lower educational level, and they buy into that. So for that reason, I think that would happen if Trump were to become president. If Hillary should become POTUS, that's pretty obvious. It's been said that those who fail to learn from history are doomed to repeat it. Those of us that are already awake and paying attention and do know history have a pretty good idea as to what that would entail. Pretty much more of the same, and I think even magnified, because she has been proven to be a tool of the Rothschilds. We know what their overall agenda is, and we know how long they look at that. What I mean by that is they don't look at it like this year or next year. You know, to the average layman who doesn't know about the Rothschilds and global domination, they look at it as hundreds of years, generationally. So, and I think there's a big disconnect with the public with regards to that piece of information. We want things right now and instantly. Right. And when you're talking about the cabal, there's nothing instant about it, unless they want to kill you, of course. So if Hillary should become president, I think it's going to go down that dark road of little by little taking away everybody's rights. And it's, of course, going to be the typical Rothschild way. And that's going to be through agreements or through anything other than just coming out and telling you, this is what we're going to do. But I do believe, to wrap that up, I do believe it would be taking away taking away the Second Amendment or a part of that. Then it would be voting. And then it's just going to be a nickel and dime of taking away our rights so they can do what they want to do. And that's
so let me ask you, so well said, let me ask you a hard question, and you guys can, sure, all of you guys can chime in. So if Hillary gets elected, do we have revolution when she tries to ratify the second, or kill the Second Amendment, or am I being way too extreme?
Well, I think that's going to depend on, and we'll get into this later, obviously, but it's going to depend on groups like Tavistock and how effective they are with the propaganda.
Right. Go ahead, Tony.
I think there's so many different levels here. Mm-hmm. First of all, the thing that I'm outraged at the most, that everybody forgets, is regardless of if it's disinfo or not disinfo or what's going to happen, just look at all the facts that we have in front of us.
Right.
The corruption at play that we now know is factual, okay? They can spin it however. Just look at the lies about
every level of our government, complete corruption.
It's never been more exposed than what it is right now.
No, not every level. I mean, look at people that work for the counties and the cities.
Federal government.
Yeah.
The corruption.
There's good people in the federal government too, though. I mean, I'm not trying to be rude here. When you make blanket statements like that, there could be somebody listening to this podcast right now that works for the federal government, and they're as straight laced as they get.
Generally,
Rex, we're not talking about individuals.
Generally
speaking, we're talking about the federal government.
We're talking about the president or the person running for the president.
Corrupt. I mean,
I just had a harp on there. And,
We're talking about the person.
Nanotechnology.
We're talking about the person that is running for our president, to be the president of our country. Right. Right. We have, this is proof. Even if there's no criminal activity that's gone on, at least, there is an absolute conflict of interest on so many levels. Okay. You have the FBI director's brother is the head VP of the company that's doing the audits of the Clinton Foundation, and also it happens to be the number five contributor ahead of Goldman Sachs to the Clinton. There's something wrong there, okay? There's something wrong on a whole nother level, okay? I mean, that to me enough tells me that we have corruption unlike ever before seen. This is a time where we have where they fire or denounce the DNC, Wasserman Schultz gets demoted. They fire these two guys that are doing this, their campaign running, where they're going around and they're inciting fights and you know, different stuff at Trump's rallies. They're firing these people. So they're admitting to guilt. But then they turn around and they say that they're all doctored emails and this is all fake.
No, it's the Russians, bro. It's the Russians.
So no.
The North Koreans, man.
I'm sorry. I disagree, because I think this level of, this is craziness. I mean, this is who the person that we're gonna elect our president? I'm not saying Trump is perfect, but we don't know enough about that side. We know enough, and we can see, if anybody with half a brain can see what's going on. We have corruption. We have a criminal that organization that that's running her campaign. That's just a glorified mob. That's a mafia stuff. What they're doing is organized crime. How are we not in up? If this was any other decade, honestly, do you think that this would even be going on? There would be such an uproar.
Well, I think people have been asleep for 40 years. And let me just correct myself, because Rex always does a good job of calling me out. I definitely am not saying that every level of the federal government is corrupt, but clearly,
and I knew you weren't.
I know. But you always do a good job. You're a good cop, bad cop.
Not to cut you short, Jay, I think the vast majority of the government are good people. You don't think
of course,
FBI?
Of course.
The FBI is outraged right now with what's going on. Okay?
Human beings are good people. And that's why I'll say, and I'm just going to throw this in again, that's why I say that when a grown man of substance rapes a child or rapes a woman, a child, a 12-year-old woman, and I won't name names, I don't believe they're human, okay? Because I am a grown man, and I know what it would be like to ever want or desire to do something like that.
That doesn't even come into our thought process.
It doesn't even come into our head. So something, and again, I don't want to go off on a tangent here, but like it's just the point of, you know, when we're talking about Hillary and Trump, we're talking about like the devil we know, which is Hillary, versus the devil we don't know, which is
exactly Trump. That's what it is.
So ultimately, though, I think that it goes back to how do we as a species, you know, sapiens, and obviously, you know, because we're in the United States, so we'll speak about the United States, but I know that we have tons of people in the Coders of Truth from every planet. How do we as a global species or global group unite to get rid of the evil, to get rid of the deception, to get rid of the cabals, as Troy accurately labels that? I mean, how do we do that, guys? Is it even possible?
Of course, we have to believe that it's possible. White light always wins. Lightness wins. So yes, that being said, yes, it will. How do I see that? That is a very unsettling thought. And that is probably the most unsettling thought that I have with regards to this political process this time around. If the white forces that are helping within our political system, because the average Joe, like we all say, we just don't have the teeth. We don't have the power. We don't. Collectively, we do, but we're not there. Only in consciousness that we're rising are we getting there. Problem is, the damage has already been done in our political system. So, that being said, how do we do that as a public? We're doing it now. Will it be in time? I think with all the leaks that have been thrown out lately, it obviously will be, according to all the talking heads. That is very unsettling, because I don't see structure. I don't see us voting. I don't know what's going to happen. For the first time ever, I don't know what's going to happen. I have all these imaginative ideas, and it's very unsettling.
Absolutely. Well said. I couldn't agree anymore.
I have a lot of feelings about white forces working, the white hats that are working for us, but will it be enough? I think it will, but if you listen to Benjamin Fulford and some of the other people, when you step outside your comfort zone, at least for me, it's stepping outside my comfort zone. And I have to rely again on resonance, and those things resonate with me. Not all of it. David Icke said it best. I try to have an open mind, just not so open you can put a dumpster in it. Right. So that being said, I try to rely on my feelings and intuition based on educated guesses, following good sources that resonate with me. I don't see a political, I keep wanting to say political. I don't see us voting this time around. Help me out, guys. Election. Thank you. Election. I don't see an election. It's too tumultuous. It's too tumultuous. Our political system right now are like clouds before a badass storm. It doesn't make sense. And that's that uneasy feeling you get before a storm. This is what you're getting right now. Same storm.
Well said. Rex, I know you're about to say something. What were you going to say?
You must have been reading my mind. I do feel there's going to be an election, and there's been a lot of people that have said the same thing you just brought up, Troy. And I even thought that for about 2 days myself, but I think that Hillary's going to win. I think that she's going to be the next president, and it's just going to be more of the same. That's what I see in our future. Now, could I be wrong? Probably not. Unfortunately, either way, I think we're in big trouble, like you said, but I certainly feel this is going to be more of the same. So regardless of what's going to happen, we'll see. It's just a couple weeks away. And then we can look back at this, and I'm going to either say, yep, I was right. I told you so. Or else you can say, see, Rex, you were wrong. And now it's chaos. And we have to buy off of solar power just to communicate. And we can't use Skype anymore because the Skype gremlins took over. And Bill Gates has turned into this giant monster with laser beams coming out of his eyeballs. Okay.
Well, Rex, I mean, you're right. In 2 weeks, you will be right. I mean, I agree. I have to agree with Rex. I don't see, as much as I'd love for the election to not happen, I do feel that Hillary will win. I just think that I look at popular culture, I look at Hollywood, I look at all the things that have happened. there's just too much of a design structure around her being put into power. Although I will say, Rex, and I know you and I talked about this before, there is the Simpsons episode from 2003 that talks about Trump being the president. So let's not discount that, because that is a fact. You can Google that and look that up right now. But they did have an episode where he was the president. And we know that Hollywood loves to give us glimpses of the future.
Oh, so, yeah.
it's possible because of that, that Trump has a realistic chance. But let's just talk, you know, let's 15 more minutes or so left in the show. Let's talk about what happens after the election. So what's going to go on in this country if Hillary wins? Tony, you get the first shot.
Wow. I'm hoping against that outcome, obviously. I don't know. I don't think you won't see anything crazy. You know, I don't think it won't be anything overnight. It won't be like, I mean, you're going to have a faction of people that are going to be upset, obviously. Yeah. There's probably going to be a big to-do, a look into the votes to see if it's, you know, if everything is correct. Who knows? There's so much uncertainty. Again, that's what we're all kind of talking about here, is that I don't think any of us have ever felt like we're not sure. I don't believe, as of right now, but tomorrow I might have a different opinion. I don't believe right now that there won't be an election. My gut for the last month has told me that Clinton's going to be elected.
Right.
But it's so fluid on a daily basis. But personally, I would have thought that with everything that's come out, I would have thought that she would have been removed from this position. Just
that's why she's not going to lose, just as Rex and I said, right? because it doesn't make any other sense.
Exactly. That's what tells me that she's handpicked, which makes things even crazier for me in my head, because, again, I've always wanted to believe that we, you know, our system was legit. Obviously, it's not. But this kind of just, I think this is an eye-opener for a lot of people. A lot of people that are really thinking about this. I mean, she's a proven criminal, okay? No matter which way you want to slice it or dice it, she's a criminal, okay? If she's got the FBI head, you know, working on her behalf, I mean, I think at the end of this, I think you're still, you have two of the two worst candidates from a popularity standpoint in this situation. There's proof that the DNC, their own DNC, has worked behind the scenes to remove Bernie Sanders, who honestly, I still to this day don't understand how Bernie Sanders is not sitting in this spot right now, right? Because just on everybody.
It was organized, because it was organized.
Of course it was, which that alone to me is more scary than anything else. I think that.
Okay, so you know you think Hillary's going to win ultimately, even though you don't want. So what happens, and Troy, you're next, and then Rex, you finish up, and then we're going to answer questions because we got a bunch. So what happens in the first 6 months?
I don't think anything crazy happens right off the bat. I think if she has her way with SCOTUS, okay, that changes everything. Because it's going to bypass a lot of what Congress wants to do if we go to a Supreme Court justice system where they can bypass and overrule things and fast track all of her plans.
Well, but also remember though, if Hillary wins, the Republicans are still going to control this.
They're shills. I mean, that's what this shows.
Well, you're right about that too. Paul Ryan's a joke.
Paul Ryan's a joke. I mean, those people, they're no different. They're no different. They're all working. They might all be working together. They probably are, man.
There's
no support out there for Trump.
They go home and they have sex with each other's wives, dude. That's the way.
Where's the support? There's no support, man. It's just, I've never seen anything like this in my life. I don't know what's to come. I still hope for the best. I'm not a fearmonger. I'm not gonna wake up tomorrow and like, oh, what was me? We're gonna go to war. I think those things are actually more important. What's going on right now over in Syria? I mean, I think those things are, you know, have more of an impact than necessarily who's president. I do think if Trump is in there, it would alleviate some of those immediate tensions that we have going on. Maybe not long term. But in the short term, I definitely think some of what's going on right now would be eradicated, because I truly do believe doing this or that is just we're creating. Why would we do that? This doesn't make sense to me. You fire people, so you're saying that it's not, and then 2 minutes later you're saying it's the, like, it just, none of it makes sense to me. Like,
all right, dude. All right, well said. Troy, you're up, and then Rex, you finish, and then we answer questions.
Well, I agree with Tony in the sense that we're not going to see anything happen right out of the get go should Hillary become POTUS. Obviously it'll be more of the same. I think the cabal working with her, as her marionette, it'll be the fast track to the cabalistic agenda. It's going to be like we talked about, the Second Amendment, and then it's going to be the Supreme Courts. And I think the average citizen will not feel it at first. And then 4 or 5 years down the road, they're going to find themselves walking funny and wondering why, just like we have done in the past with these folks. Yep. You know, I voted for Clinton twice in the 90s. He's relatively well off. I was making six figures, so I voted as a Texan. I voted against my family, voted Democrat, taxing myself because I knew we needed the taxes at that time. We were coming off of our deficit, and Bill Clinton did balance the budget at that time. But again, I wasn't awake yet. I just didn't know any better. You know, shame on all of us, and I'm not going to beat myself up for that. But the point I'm trying to make is we had good intentions then, but now we're rubbing our asses walking funny. And if Hillary becomes president, it's going to be the same thing again. She's already shown it time and again.
Yep. We'll have that.
Right, Rex, go ahead.
Sure. You know, as far as raising taxes or whatever, if you look at the system that's set up with the fiat currency, there has to be more debt continually in order to keep this system in play.
Absolutely.
And really the fiat currency that we have, fiat systems aren't bad. I mean, they're actually a good thing. They're based on the, you know, what the people that are actually out there, the consumers, how they feel about the economy, you and me, as well as the bankers as well. But the fiat currency can be a good thing. Now, the problem is when it's based on debt, you continue to create more debt, more debt, more debt, more debt. There has to be cyclical outcomes. You have to have this, you know, compress, decompress, et cetera. And it's just an opportunity for these guys to know when to sell, know when to buy, except with real estate, with stocks, with everything else. They're going to continue to do this unless it gets to a point to where they decide to go into a full digital system, kind of like Mr. Robot's portraying the TV series and what's been talked about for years, take the microchip, et cetera. I know people personally that have that microchip in their hand. They go to the store, they swipe it across the counter, they purchase their goods. They don't even have to pull out their credit card. I mean, you can get so lazy now, folks, pretty soon you're just going to be able to sit down in your lazy boy chair. You're going to be able to put on your virtual reality headset, do everything, suck down super big gulps, eat Big Macs all you want. And then there's going to be plenty of pharmaceutical drugs that will keep you nice, dilapidated and comfortable in that environment, and you won't have to do anything because Hillary Clinton is going to support your habits, ladies and gentlemen. Vote Hillary if you want to plug into the Matrix and be a part of this Borg system where they will feed you lithium tablets. You're going to love it. And if you're depressed, we have more opportunities in pharmaceutical drugs that might not work. They might make you want to kill yourself more, but it's okay because it's all over TV right now. I just saw it. I mean, if you watch Fox News, there's all sorts of commercials you can watch about how there's drugs out there that might kill you, but they might help you, maybe, but they're not sure about that. You'll most likely die or have a heart attack or maybe get Crohn's disease or have a neurological disorder, or maybe you'll fall down to your death with Tourette's, but it might stop you from having restless leg syndrome.
Right.
I'm digressing.
No. Well said. So we have three really good questions I want all of us to answer, and then we're done, probably 10, 12 minutes, whatever. But the first question is perfect seed for what you just said, Rex, about just vote for Hillary and plug back in. So this guy's question is, it's James Newworth from the Decoders. Good question, James. Thank you for asking it. How can people not see the corruption that all of us in the Decoders of Truth see that you guys are talking about right now?
Oh, that's what I was going
to
bring up.
Yeah, and then and choose to stay living in the Matrix, unevolved, unaware. Go first, Rex.
Yeah, let me go first on that. So thank you for asking that question, because that's what I wanted to talk about until I went on that strange tangent. Okay, so the people in office now, you look at, okay, well, what about this? Or what about those emails or this corruption or, you know, Bloodgate or all these scenarios? And, you know, people can go, the body count goes on for a mile long. There's plenty of information out there. Even in the mainstream news, you can pick and choose which article you want to. When has it not been corrupt at those levels for the most part? I mean, even if you go back to the founding of this nation, the way that not only were the natives just slaughtered, I mean, they would cut their scalps like you would to a bunny that was not even a bunny rabbit, that was rabbit or something that had big giant ears, you know, like those big jackrabbits that have a bunch of like bugs that are in their ears and they look like they're miserable anyway. But anyway, I mean, it's just the kind of stuff that we did to find this nation, the way that it was started, everything else. If you ask me, that it's always been there. So to say that, because people aren't going to care about that, man, they never have. They emotionally get attached, just like going out and buying a car or a new RV or a new boat. You get them emotionally attached. And then they want it. They don't care. They just see that change. They go into this tunnel vision and nothing else matters because they're right. That's why most people stay plugged into the system and they're not as astute as people that listen into this Decoders of Truth, people like yourselves that are really wanting to break out of that. If you want to break out of the system, you can do it, ladies and gentlemen. Are you going to be as comfortable as you are right now? Probably not. Go out and set yourself up with energy off the grid. Find a way to set up a garden. Quit going to the grocery stores. Quit paying the utility companies. Find a way to unplug. There's opportunities out there. You can do it. They don't have martial law set in place now where if you actually go out and try and set something like that up, you can do it right now. It's available. So that's what I would recommend for people that really want to break out of the Matrix. If you're working a 9-to-5 job, if you're doing something where you have to tell yourself at the end of the day, it's just a job, I've got to have one. If you have that kind of job, maybe you should find another one.
Totally. Well, well said, Rex. Let me just follow up with that. Tony, jump in. I know Troy will be right back. Again, it comes back to this idea that, like, listen, it's okay to be aware, but as Rex very accurately said, if you think you're going to just check out or cash out of the money magic system and live a better life than you're probably living right now, you know, again, as much as people want to complain about it, you're probably hallucinating.
Okay? I agree.
Because unless you've got 50 million large in the bank and an offshore account, and you could go afford to buy yourself a compound and hope on ascending, you know, to the top of wherever you want to ascend, you know, at your luxury, because you don't have to worry about feeding yourself, then, you know, be my guest, man, and invite me, because I'm in. I'm a player.
Hello.
But at the end of the day, we all do have a role to play in life. And Rex, what you just said about the job thing is great. You know, find something that is a career, not a job. Find something that you love to do and challenges you and stimulates you and makes you wake up and say, yes, I'm excited about today. So if you're not doing that and you're in a Borg job, then find a better lifestyle. That's up to you. But again, all of us can be aware and we can live our lives accordingly and still live in the money magic system. Now, again, you've got to be in service to others. You can't be focused on money, 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 greed, 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 cut people off, fuck people over. That's not what you're trying to do. But you can still be aware and still live in the system. And I'm seeing a lot of people in the Decoders of Truth that are trying to, like, they're really having, like, spiritual quandaries or moral, you know, platitudes about, like, I don't know what to do, you know. And I won't lie, there's been times in my life where I've, you know, questioned my own stuff. You know, I wanted to go to Tibet and just focus on that. But, I mean, dude, I'm a father. I have kids. I have a wife. You know, I have a career. I have a really good life that I live. I'm not going to just throw it all away because I feel like the whole system is corrupt, even though I know that it is. But so the reality is like, and you guys, you know, Troy and Tony jump in here and answer, you guys get your answer here too. But Rex said it very, very well. There's gotta be balance. Like all things in life, you gotta have balance. You know, you have to be passionate and happy, hopefully. I mean, happiness is a choice, but just, you gotta find balance, man. Be aware, but at the same time, you know, do something to contribute to society. And if that gives you money or gives you a better life, then that's good.
It's said that the first time we ever took a commercial timeout, sports were changed forever. It's kind of the same thing with people. The moment that we gave Junior a participation trophy, society was changed forever. We have evolved into a society of a sense of entitlement, a heavy sense of entitlement. People no longer push themselves. They're not always like you and me, Jay, and like Tony, where we get outside our comfort zones. You know, when's the last time someone timed themselves in a 2-mile run? How many push-ups can you do? When's the last time you really pushed yourself? Most people in today's society have never played high sports. So until you had to push yourself, reach a personal goal, and not just get a participation trophy, you're not going to understand that, and you're going to get caught up in the matrix. And I think that's one thing that separates the different groups of people within our group. Everybody has their own path that they're on, and we welcome that, and everybody has a different path. And they're speaking their own truths, but we're all brought together because of Aquarius, Age of Enlightenment. We're all waking up, and we see that. But when you have a society, it's just... it's so hydratic, multi-headed problems that we face. I want to wrap this up. One last thing. It's been on my mind a lot, this last part of this conversation. We need a global reset. I've done my fair share of theology studying, and I keep feeling potter's clay, Troy, potter's clay. It's just like the potter's clay. We are not going to experience, I don't give a crap what we talk about, who wins, who does this, it's all irrelevant in its most simplistic forms. We are not going to accomplish a damn thing until the whole some bitch is just smashed and started all over again. Because if you take every single issue that we've talked about and that this country and this globe faces, every single one of them, we tried that, it's already screwed up. Well, that needs to be refixed. When everything we look at needs to be fixed, you need the potter's clay. And that's the bottom line in its most simplistic forms, in my opinion.
Well said, man. Go ahead, Tony.
Very well said. I agree with a lot of what all of you guys said. Going back to the original question, it was James, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with him completely. I mean, but it's crazy that that so many people are not aware. I mean, that's my feeling. I'm like outraged that the average Joe doesn't even have an idea about anything that we're discussing. And an age in time where you would think that people would have more access to all of this information, like all of us. So that is kind of alarming to me. As far as what you were just mentioning, Troy, I mean, I agree with a lot of what you're saying. But honestly, let's come to the realization that that's not going to ever happen, okay? Even a utopian environment, while that sounds great and dandy, and listen, I would love for that to exist. I know that there's, you know, the Tellinger, the Ubuntu thing that he has going on, and maybe that's great. I told Jay I would love to go to South Africa for 2 weeks or a month just to check out how that is. I think that all sounds great, but let's be real with ourselves. In a global environment, is that ever going to happen? I mean, realistically, the only way that ever happens is if we have something along the lines of a cataclysmic event. Okay, so maybe I mean, that's the only way. I mean, if you want to get religious and start talking, you know, prophecy and theology and, you know, that's, I mean, a lot of religions all tie to the same thing, you know. There's something that happens and, you know, that kind of resets us. You know, that's the only way I see something happen. Granted, I'm not a doomsday guy. I'm not hoping.
Nor am I. I agree. Yeah. Nor am I. I agree.
But let's be real with ourselves. That is never going to happen. It's never going to happen. And if anything, all the events that are happening today, even though they're being pushed at us like they're meant to bring us together, it's doing the opposite. If you guys think that the stuff that's going on with the cops right now, with everybody kneeling for the national anthem, this is just proof that they're pushing us for more divide.
It's just an agenda. It's a control agenda, for sure.
It's a control agenda, okay? You see that.
Oh, yeah.
When you see these leaks with these people, when they're mentioning, trying to do, oh, it's a white guy that killed a black guy, it's even better for, I mean, come on. They're pushing that to be their agenda. They're pushing for more divide. And when are people going to wake up to that? That our own people are pushing for this divide because it benefits them. Okay, that's the big thing. It keeps everybody in control. When you hear statistics like 60% of Americans rely on the government for some form of benefit, okay, they're going to keep pushing that agenda because why? It keeps putting them back in the slave system. It keeps them to rely upon that system. They're not going to turn their backs on that hand, or they're not going to bite the hand that's feeding them. I mean, come on, use your heads. These people aren't stupid. They know what they're doing. It's a form of bribery. Okay, so for me personally, you know, I became self-employed about 10 years ago. Listen, you know, I was in a shitty marriage. I thought materialistic things would be great. It would make me happy again. You know, that it would, you know, buying things and accumulating wealth and doing all this shit would make me happy. I soon learned and realized that all that shit in the grand scheme of things will tell you that it loves you. None of that shit matters. It's all irrelevant, okay? And unfortunately, in the grand scheme of things, that's not the way society is. Society is not, you know, that's not how it's pushed to us. We're in a world where the Kardashians and all that bullshit.
I'm losing him.
But like, that's this great form of, it's all bullshit, okay? So this idea that we're gonna have some kind of universal or an Ubuntu-like, you know, a universal, you know, utopian-like environment, we're fooling ourselves, unfortunately. I don't hate to say that or sound like I'm a negative person, but that's not the way.
Yeah, you gotta speak your truth.
No, I mean, not in the current situation. Okay, so there's two more questions. Rex, you go first on this, and I wanna answer. But it seeks to what we're just saying. But the first question is they're all asking how soon is financial collapse or financial rearrangement or financial change? That's the first question that we're going to answer, all of us. And then the second, which is the last question, is can we make change? Can this change that we're all talking about and hoping for can come about peaceably or peace through peace and not revolution and violence? So anyway, the second question is financial change, collapse, what's coming? Rex, your thoughts.
Okay, so obviously I don't know the answer to that. I can tell you what my speculation is, and we talked about this recently with the series that are out there portraying the collapse of the dollar. The new system will be similar to the Bitcoin. I've talked to Cliff High several times from WebBots. His predictions are coming up to Bitcoin is going to be the new system of exchange. Now, it is right now, obviously, but he thinks it'll be more mainstream. So there could be a collection of these digital currencies that become more mainstream. I mean, there's already plenty of them out there. There's more than just Bitcoin. You can look into this kind of stuff, but it should become more mainstream here soon when these power players become more heavily vested in that set of currencies into that digital network. And then they can kind of let go, you know, of those other interests that they have in the fiat system as it collapses. So they don't have to worry about paying that back, essentially that additional debt. That's what I see happening. Now, will that be linked to some type of space weather event? Will that be linked to this ginormous planet that's on the outskirts of the solar system that's been talked about for hundreds of years, yet nobody can actually see it? But supposedly people that have died. I'm still on the fence about that. Just because there's this huge thing on the internet talking about these astronomers that died shortly after they exposed Planet X, there's still other options. And here's the thing too with the leak project, with the comments people leave, even in just one specific channel, and there's millions of channels out there, it makes me realize how the internet is so effective of creating something out of nothing. If you want to talk about alchemy at its finest, and these guys know this, they're a part of think tanks and they've got software recognition programs. They've got pre-software stuff that figures out what you're going to do before you can even do it, calculating quadrillions of floating points per second, etc. So when there's this little tiny story that comes out there that's really nothing, one person will pick that up and say, oh, it's a conspiracy. It's actually a four-headed alien that actually shapeshifts into this giant mantis and then back to an X-Man character. It's real. I saw it with my own eyes. Well, then they're going to come up with something that makes it real. They're going to find a picture that makes it real, etc., when it never even existed. And the stuff that I read even in the comments of leak projects, some of the stuff people say, I'm thinking to myself, Are you serious? Right. I mean, you've got to be so, and so that's why I do my best to keep track of most of the comments, but I can't keep track of all of them because I don't want some stupid story. Like, you know, for example, the spam folder. Spam will automatically pick up people's comments when they put links sometimes. I never even get these comments. And then someone will leave a comment. Oh, are you banning my comments? Are you erasing my comments? Well, you know, you're a part of the system, man. You're an agent. You work for the machine. And I'm like, dude, it's in a spam folder. And sometimes I'm just, it's just unbelievable. The way
there's two famous now, Rex. Can't make friends with everybody, dude.
Well, you got to question everything. I question everything. And I am so much more agnostic ever since doing Leak Project. I'll tell you, I used to think I knew what was going on. Now I have no idea. Ladies and gentlemen, that's a fact.
So you're saying Bitcoin, but I'm going to pin you down here. So you're saying Bitcoin, but are you saying you see a major event in the next 6 to 12 months that changes the currency, collapses the currency where it causes chaos, or you're not seeing that?
No, I'm not seeing it.
Okay. So you just say it'll be a natural evolution to Bitcoin and it'll happen in the next year, you think?
No. I think it's going to happen over the next 5 to 7 years. That's what my intuition is telling me.
Okay, cool. So, okay, I'll go next and you guys finish. So I look at I analyze financial data for a living in our real estate business in Southern California. And I talk to clients about this stuff all the time. I see a total collapse. Now, when I say a collapse, I mean a depression. Okay. Whatever is coming what we have going on right now is completely unsustainable. If you look at all the Fortune 500 companies in the world, they are levered to the point that it's 10 to 15 times worse than it was in 2007. The reason that is because of qualitative easing, because of all these low interest rates and cheap money. And so all those companies have just taken advantage of that outcome. Now, Rex is right when he says that debt is engineered and that we need that to go around. And the world is now a giant circle. If China goes off the rails, Australia goes off the rails, South Africa goes off the rails. So understanding all that, I only go by the bond situation. Okay. And right now the bond market is about 30% of the GDP income wise of the richest people in the world, the guys that manage the hedge funds. Okay. The serious high level institutional investor, venture cap people, those guys are all set up that if there isn't an interest rate increase by the end of December, they will be wiped out. You can go to Bill Gross's website. You can read all you want for all you decoders of truth. You think I'm talking out of my ass. You can go read what Bill Gross, who's like the most famous bond trader in the history of the world, is writing about the end of December. And that's why the Federal Reserve President, Janet Yellen, has already told everybody, if you read between the lines, that they're going to raise rates in December. And it could be a quarter point. It could be a half a point. Now, as Rex has said on previous podcasts, and I have reiterated, the average person in the United States right now, 80% of society cannot write a check for $400. Okay. Exactly. Now let me make very simple math to everybody out there. Okay. If they raise interest rates half a point, that means that the interest payment that people are making, which is minimal on their credit card debt, their car loans, all of their installment loans, doubles. So when you take the average person in America who has $400 to his name and you make all their minimum payments double, wipe out.
You're assuming everybody's on assumable mortgages.
So ultimately, we are going to have a serious financial situation at some point next year. I won't make a prediction when, but my guess is it's going to happen within the first 6 months of next year. Because again, if they raise rates in December, all those things come due by about the second week of March. So you will start seeing layoffs. You will start seeing people suffer. Okay. And then also we always, again, the media, right? We know that there's six companies controlling everything. Ultimately, at the end of the day, we live in a technologically advanced society. We have the most amazing technology. Everything is more efficient now. We have a massive, massive portion of our society is still brick and mortar. We have tons of people that are employed at Walmarts and Targets and Best Buys and places like that, these giant chains. They're all going to be obsolesced by Amazon. Yep. In 2 months, Amazon is going to be droning like 60% of the United States, so that when you buy something, it's going to be guaranteed at your doorstep within 4 hours, right? Everybody's all excited about 2-day free shipping on Amazon now. Well, imagine when it's 2 and 4 hours.
Yep.
So when you look at that, you have to understand that the massive portion of the United States is still employed by brick and mortar is going to lose their jobs. Okay, so again, this isn't negative. This isn't doom and gloom. This is just analyzing the data, looking at the future and looking at what's going on. And I say, we haven't had a depression since 1930 or 1929. I think it was from 1929 to 1936. No one even knows what a depression's like anymore. That's what's going to come. There's going to be a lot of people out of work, and there's going to be, you know, lower wages and just a lower quality of life. And then once it overcomes, we overcome that, and we will, we'll have the greatest golden age ever. There'll be, as Rex is right, I agree with him. There'll be a currency collapse. or not a collapse, but a change to a digital format, and that's a way we go. But I still see as immense suffering for the next 4 to 6 years before it changes. That's my guess.
Let me just jump in for 1 second. Now, you brought up the depression, and you know, I could certainly see not a depression, but you know, the government kind of, not the government kickbacks essentially and stuff like that, maybe. Well, maybe more like 2008, essentially, but I do not see a depression. And here's why. My grandpa grew up in the depression. And I mean, the guy is just the most amazing person. That general, in my opinion, is far beyond anything that I could ever achieve. Just amazing person. But to make a long story short, he told me stories about how when he was growing up, he remembers his mom would cry because she didn't know if she had enough coupons for milk and supplies, essentially.
I have them in my family too. They went days without eating food.
So you think it's going to get that intense again?
I don't even think so. If you put a gun to my head right now, I'm telling you, I just analyzed the data, dude. There's no way that this country can sustain the debt levels that it has right now on its own making. There has to be an index. Rates cannot go to zero. They can't. They will collapse. The globe, it's that circle. You know, there's already countries right now that have negative interest rates. There's just, it's not sustainable. Can they lower rates further and extend this Ponzi further? Yes. Could they extend it another year or two? Yes. Will they collapse the bond market? Yes. And that will wipe out a lot of wealth of very wealthy people. That can happen, but it's just not sustainable, man.
Mm-hmm. Well, it hasn't been sustainable in years, essentially. And, you know,
there was a wipeout in 2000, when the dot-coms.
I remember. Oh, yeah. Big time.
And then they ran it back up with free money, you know, in the real estate economy, and then they collapsed the real estate economy. But people had, this is what I tell people, in 2001, when it collapsed, people were flush from tech stock investment. They had massive amounts of money.
The stocks in Wall Street, but the WWW were off the hook, worldwide web.
I mean, people had money from tech stocks that they invested wisely from the 90s. And then the same thing happened with real estate. They'd used their houses as ATM banks. So then they had money from that when it collapsed. But this time when it goes down, people don't have savings. There's no tree of money or, you know, backbone to pull out of like they had in 2000 and 2008. And that's why I'm saying it's going to be a depression. I don't see the government with no way to go any. They've already shot all their bullets.
Yeah, you hit it right on the head.
Now, technology and with what's going on with the digital currencies, with the internet, with everything else out there, with people like yourself, I think that we're actually going to be able to keep certain systems in play. I don't think it's going to be as bad as the depression. If it gets that bad because of the weapons that people have and the entitlements that people have, you're going to see stuff that is absolutely mind-blowing. I mean, you're going to see stuff similar to type scenarios. And I just don't see that. I don't think that people are too, not all of us, obviously. I mean, you know, not us here, but most people are too dilapidated. They're not in good enough shape. They've got too many entitlements. They've been force-fed this entitlement program their whole lives. I do not see that. It's going to be like Idiocracy, man. People are just going to be continuing to become dilapidated, more retarded. It's going to continue to go downhill. It's going to be this slow scale. But as far as depression goes, we've got too much technology now. The world is too global now to get to that level. I mean, it's going to be a different type of depression.
They've already eliminated the middle class. Sure, the technology benefits the elite, the top 1% or 2%, but the rest of the people just don't have anything. And if they can't pay for it, who's going to pay for it?
Let me help. It's nothing like the depression, man. You know what? I've told you about my friend. Well, I could be wrong. Hey, I could be wrong. We'll know soon. And this is just
maybe about 8 months, we'll know.
We'll know. Absolutely. But when I talk to people that have actually grown up in the depression, and when I look at technology now and the way that everything is, unless there is a huge technological collapse, meaning we don't have access to this kind of stuff right now, communications, because we're a global network now. We're a global network. If you're in Kansas, if you're in New York City, if you're in South Korea, and virtually anywhere you are, it's a global network. So
that doesn't fix anybody from not having money, dude.
Wait a second.
I was talking about my friend who used to work for the Federal Reserve. And so he has been to those meetings. He's worked with the Federal Reserve for years. He doesn't anymore. We've talked about this many times. And he says they're just going to keep adding zeros. Now, I do see this cyclical system going. But as far as the depression goes, you really think it's going to be to the point to where people are going to go out? I mean, what are people going to do with this many people?
Food lines, dude. Right now, if you don't have any money, you're going to depend on the government to feed you. But what is the government?
Venezuela.
The government is broke. The government has no money. What are they going to do? Just print more money? Nobody's going to sustain it. China and Russia aren't going to back it. The BRICS country, the BRICS nations have already told us they're not going to back our currency. As soon as the dollar is not a reserve currency of the world, it's ollie oxen free.
You're right. They've been saying that since 2011, though. In 2011, supposedly Iran was going to go away from the petrodollar. And these, you know, but we're still there. I mean, they've been saying this for 5 years. When that happens, you could be right. But guess what happens when they say that, in my opinion? Oh, you're not going to take these. You're not going to take this anymore. Well, we're just going to bomb the shit out of you.
Well, that's a great point, because how did we get out of the last depression? We manufactured war.
No way. Really?
That's right.
There's money there? I mean, that's why we've been in constant war for how many years now? I mean, think about that for a minute. Gaddafi, right? He was going to get out of the petrodollar system. He was going to start the African continent movement, where a bunch of countries were going to join together, get out of the petrodollar. What happened to him? Oh, well, he had to get killed because he was suppressing the people. He was so mean to his people that we just had to go there, kill him, take his gold. And now there's nothing. You don't hear anything about that anymore.
Man, so, look, I hope I'm wrong, dude, because, like, obviously we have an amazing business and I don't want my business to go down. I just look at the numbers, man, and it's already happening. The DOJ is looking at cash transactions over $1 million now. There's no anything that comes in that's remotely funny. They're just like, nope, we're going to scrutinize this. And so it's already dropping the buyer pool for the high-end stuff. The rich people in Manhattan and Miami have already pulled out. There's massive projects in New York City that were $400-500 million have already been, the financing's been pulled. I'm telling you, this is the same shit that they orchestrated in 2007 and 2008. It's coming back. I know, Tony, what you're going to say, because you and I already talked about it. You know what's going on in Miami. It's just, but at this time, I just don't see people, the general Joe public drinking six packs and eating pizzas. I don't see them as able to have reserves to be able to push this side out like they did in 2008, 2009. That was a different time. I could be completely wrong. I just see it. I see depression. I see the government feeding people. That's what I see.
Yeah.
Maybe a serious recession. I'm saying maybe a serious recession. You're saying depression.
Well, how do you define 2008? Because that was a serious recession, correct? 2009, 2008.
I mean, okay, at that particular time, I was working for a Fortune 100 company. I'd been with them for years. I saw the writing on the wall because I'd been keeping track of the stock markets. I talked to a friend of mine that worked for the Department of Defense for many years, Ben and Langley, et cetera. I told him what was going on. He said, okay, be ready. They're going to start laying off a bunch of people.
Right.
They did. They closed a bunch of stores down. They laid a bunch of people off, about 50% of the people. The stocks went from $60 a share to $3 a share.
Right.
Now it's $90 a share again. But yeah, dude, and I stayed with the company. I saw that happen.
But don't you see the more layoffs coming this time with all the brick and mortar companies going out of business?
I'm seeing it now. You're already seeing it now. Look at Caterpillar.
I love you, dude.
China Pillar.
Go back and forth on this all day. I don't see a solution other than a decline, cleaning up the system, breaking it out, breaking out of it. I agree with you 100% on the currency thing, but I don't see it being efficient. I don't see being like an economy of scale where everything just like indexes for 3 or 6 months or something. I see a long, you know, time before we adjust. And people
What about a 15% devaluation of the fiat dollar?
I agree with you on that. That could help. That could definitely work. But I still think that that would be great, but we're not taking into effect the workforce. We're still going to lose 30%. That's an estimate of the entire global workforce that's connected to brick and mortar establishment companies. And those people are not going to get technology jobs. You cannot take a 60-year-old person who doesn't know how to type and put them in some sort of a data entry job. It's not going to happen.
No.
It's just not going
to
happen.
You're making some great points, and that's why this is what we really need to do. And when it all comes down to it, Jay, you're bringing up some amazing points. I think that this is a good conversation we're having right now because it's bringing up ideas. It's getting people thinking. This is a healthy conversation. That's what I like about talking to you guys, is because we don't agree on everything. So what do? We have a conversation about it. We're coming up with solutions and ideas. We're giving our thoughts into this. We're not saying we know for sure. We're giving the data that we have. And that's what I think is going to be key to solving any problem, is working together. But here's the deal. If you want to get rid of this entire system, do you know what Germany did when they were a bankrupt nation and took wheelbarrows of currency to buy a loaf of bread? You know what happened, right? Well, the administration said, we're not going to continue to pay these offshore loans anymore. Right. We're going to make our own freaking currency. And guess what? We can back up currency that we create because we can give people jobs. We can say, okay, go work on this bridge, go work on that road, go build this building, make that specific car. We're going to pay these engineers. We're going to pay these inventors. We're going to pay these people that are really good on the internet, these specific white hat hackers or, you know, alphabet agency guys that are good or whatever. You can revolutionize an entire new system just by saying, we are not going to pay these offshore interest anymore. We're going to make our own currencies. And if you want to come after us, come get us.
And I think in a sense, that's what's going to happen. I tend to agree with Jay. It's going to collapse. We can only puff it up so much. And we've been doing that for ages. And like I said earlier, when you look at Caterpillar, when you look at real estate markets, I'm in retail. When you look at retail sales, and the numbers are staggeringly low, and they're not getting any. We can't keep stroking the numbers like we've been doing. It's non-sustainable, like I said earlier. And it will collapse. And we also factor in, if I may, we haven't talked about this. What about China? Tony could probably talk about this. Today was a big thing on China in a basket, GSRs, China, basically trying to get rid of the dollar on trading. And that goes back to Libya and why we got rid of Gaddafi and why we got rid of Saddam. You know, they wanted to get off the dollar, the petrodollar.
They were suppressing their people.
So, you know, it's... we can't stroke it anymore like we already have, and it's not sustainable. And I think we are going to see a major collapse. I really do.
All right, Tony, go ahead. And then we'll answer that last question, and Rex, you go first.
Yeah, I mean, Rex, I hope that your scenario is right. I really do. Unfortunately, I also have been tracking, and I've been listening to Jay. You know, Jay was telling me this a year ago, and he's in the real estate business. He's warning other real estate people what he envisions happening. And I started following and paying attention, looking at some of these hedge funds and some of these analysts that are out there. And yeah, I mean, if you look at things, they are leveraged to their necks, okay? Mm-hmm. Just 3 months ago, for the first time, supposedly in the history of our government, both the VP and the president met with the Fed, okay, behind closed doors. Never ever happened before that the three were in the same room. You're not supposed to have the president and the VP in the same room at the same time. They're always supposed to be separated.
Well, remember, the Federal Reserve is not part of the government.
It's a separate entity. All met in the same room for the same time. A lot of people speculated that it's to hold off whatever was supposed to happen now until after the election.
Right.
Okay? So something is coming, no matter what. Something is absolutely coming, whether it's a major depression or it's a full-blown major bad recession. That's where we're headed. And people, again, factor in all the other things that are going into play here, which politics does play a role. Obamacare is about to dramatically jump, okay? People are going to be broke. I mean, it's going to be worse.
Broker,
exactly. When Amazon goes into effect, when they start doing these drops, which has been kind of been pushed off for a while, is that supposed to go into effect coming up here?
4 months. Seattle's already doing it right now. They have 2 hours.
And there's a big thing with that too. Again, if you look who owns Amazon, you go back to all that. But Amazon's bypassing taxes right now, which is
always
a big
thing. Always
you know, which is a big thing right now. But when that starts happening, now you're eliminating delivery systems.
Oh yeah.
Warehousing. The transportation industry's done. All the trucking.
You're eliminating retail. You're eliminating so many different factors. So you're going to have a ton. Just common sense says there's going to be the unemployment level is going to skyrocket. You're going to have people that still are employed paying out more for healthcare. And then, you know, there's other factors.
They won't pay. They'll just not pay.
You have a society getting dumber and dumber at the exact same time that all the requirements for what's needed is higher and higher.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah, why do you think now 1 in 6 children have some type of autism or neurological disorder? Why do you think that they put certain adjuvants in the vaccines and they make them in China so they don't even know what's in them? Oh, no, there's no connection there whatsoever, ladies and gentlemen. Absolutely not. It's unbelievable what's going on right now. But as far as this currency system goes, if you really think about it, let me be political here for a second. Oh, well, Rex, you're saying that what we should do is just tell all these offshore factions we're not going to pay them back any money and start our own new currency system? No, not necessarily. Do we start our own new currency? Yes, absolutely we do. Now, are there certain people that are making so much money off of the system's interest alone because of the way that they created the system that we'll never be able to pay that back? Well, hey, maybe we don't pay them back, but what about these countries out there that have helped us and given us assistance and we need to pay them back? So how do we do it? Here's a perfect scenario, ladies and gentlemen. If you're creating your own currency and if you're using that currency to pay workers from your nation, you could take 1,000 workers to go work in a different country and you could pay them with your money to help that country so they wouldn't have to have their citizens working jobs and taking certain investments out, et cetera. I mean, there's a million ways to do it, but we live in this just archaic system of retardation where so many people are so brain damaged and under mind control that they can't think for themselves. And because it's on CNN and Fox News, it must be real, even though we know it's not real. It's got to be real because it's on the mainstream news. I mean, we're messing with our own brains. Once we can say, hey, look, you're not going to assimilate me. I'm not going to put up with your bullshit anymore. I'm going to have my own way of getting energy. I'm going to have my own way of getting food and having clean water. And if I need to have some type of treatment because I have a little cough, I don't need to go to the hospital and get on 5 different antibiotics that are going to eat my nervous system and my digestive tract up. I mean, my grandma's 82 years old. She's in perfect health. She's never had an antibiotic or vaccine in her life.
And they're probably pushing
us. My aunt goes out and gets a flu vaccine 1 year, and guess what? Immediately after she gets the flu vaccine, she gets these red welts all over her body. She's been healthy her whole life, too. And the doctor goes, oh, well, yeah, I don't know. I mean, yeah, it's not the vaccine that caused that. It did cause it to happen faster, but it could have happened anyway. The vaccine just caused it to happen faster. I mean, do doctors listen to themselves talk? I have a family member that's in emergency medicine. I have another family member that's one of the lead doctors in Missouri. And the guy's brilliant, but he's a moron at the same time. Because they're programmed with all this pharmaceutical mind control, MK Ultra conditioning in college and in the meetings and seminars that they go to, they can't see with their own two eyes. It's unbelievable how powerful mind control is, ladies and gentlemen.
All right. Hold on, Tony. So I'm not leaving you. This is because you're answering the question. So do we have a chance at peaceful change into the golden age or not?
I don't see it, unfortunately. And I'm not trying to be a doomsayer. I just don't think, we can't get along, you know, our two presidential candidates can't get along for 5 minutes.
Call in the helicopters.
What's that to say about us as a nation or as people? No, unfortunately, I don't see that happening. It sounds great and I would love for everybody to just get along, but there's so much division right now. How can you even contemplate or imagine a scenario where everybody just says, let's all shake hands and do this and get along? It's not happening.
So you're saying massive financial change, whether it's collapse, depression, major recession, within how long?
There's a lot of factors in play, but.
Well, give me a timeline. I say
within a year.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would agree.
Okay, Troy agrees. Okay, so then Rex, can we change, this is it. I'll finish up. Troy, you'll have the last say. Can we honestly change and move into a golden age peacefully?
Absolutely. Now, what's your definition of change and what's your definition of golden age?
So how do we, a golden age is obviously the age of Aquarius, but you know, none of this nonsense, free energy, you know, no more cabal, no more, you know, NWO, no more elites controlling all of us. I mean, like literally sea change.
Overthrow.
Well, let me ask you this. If we can do things peacefully, obviously, now can the people that have the control in the petroleum industry, are they willing to let go peacefully? I think that's what the question should be. Now, if there's a way we can get to them, if there's a way we can unplug their minds from this dark beast system that literally feeds off of the planet and people and goodness, and if you really think about what these companies profit off of, for example, the nail that they're spraying in the atmosphere to get rid of mosquitoes because they're creating this huge campaign that the Zika virus is causing microcephaly, or I think is the name of it, where you've got these miniature heads on these babies that are born. Yeah. And all of the proof that I have seen, all of the scientific data points that it's actually the insecticides and the chemicals that are being sprayed causing this, not the Zika virus itself. And ladies and gentlemen, you can actually buy the Zika virus. It's available dry package. It's a freeze-dried package. You can pick it up for like, I think it's $47 or something like that. They've got different price points, different amounts you can purchase. The reason I'm saying this is because if the Zika virus is that deadly, and it might be, why is it available to purchase on the internet through a website that's totally legit as a, you could purchase it, I think. Now, don't quote me on how you can purchase it as far as if you have to have a certain license, but I didn't see any licensing that you needed or anything like that. And that's the kind of stuff, if you really think about it, you guys, we're being sprayed with poison in the air. They're putting poison in the food. They're putting poison in the water. They're putting it in medicines. They're putting it in supplements. And nobody's doing anything about it now. Do you really think people give a damn if somebody goes into office because they've got 30,000 emails that are leaked or because some people got killed because of what they did? I mean, yeah, people are going to go uproar about it, but is anything really going to happen? Probably not. They're just going to come up with another scenario. Oh, well, guess what? This guy had 57,000 emails that was released. Oh, this one had 115,000 emails, and guess what?
Hold on.
They're having sex with donkeys. Woo-haw!
Come on, dude.
Donkey sex politicians.
That was a really good tangent, but now you're going to answer the question because you know I'm going to hold you to it. So if you're saying all those things and these horrible people are in charge of us, so how the hell are we going to change it?
I just told you. Fucking unplug. We unplug. We say, okay, we're going to start a new system. We're going to get enough people together. We're going to purchase this land. We're going to make sure we have enough treaties and enough documentation in place that if they attack us or if they do anything over this specific land, like if they're spraying chemtrails over it or if they find somebody to get Monsanto seeds on this land, then it could be considered an act of war. That is really a possibility in order to get out of this system. Now, what's another thing you can do? Well, they just sold a township in South Dakota. Buy a township, set up a sheriff there.
Let's start the movement. You got 55,000 subscribers. Let's do it. We'll talk about it after the show. Tony, you're up.
I think that sounds great, man. I would love to jump on it. But do we really, honestly, guys, do you think that that's going to happen? I mean, be honest with you.
What's going on right now?
And I trust me, I'm not trying to be negative against what you're thinking is, but we have, this is a time where literally the population, 5% or less knows what the tax plans of either candidate is going on. It's such a divided
world. I just had two people reach out to me in Missouri that have homestead programs. One is myozarkhomestead.com. I can't remember the name of the other outfit. Really nice people. They even said, "Hey Rex, if you want to come out here, we've got an extra spot for you. Come on out. We'll help you out. You can do what you do, and you can wake people up. You can continue to get people aware of what's going on, and we'll help you out up
here." They probably don't have broadband internet there, though.
Oh, they got broadband. I mean, they got more than broadband. It's incredible. So there's people doing it, man. But now, is it going to get to the point? If once you push these guys in a corner too far, they're going to fight back. They're going to lash out. So they've got the technology right now to keep the entire planet docile.
They could drone. You're right. They could drone all of us in every major city in a matter of 3 hours. My brother's told me that. He's like, "Jay, you do not even understand the drone technology. They can literally take out the entire city of Los Angeles in 3 hours.
I told you guys about the time a Lockheed Martin surfaced air missile flew past me on Highway 10 in Texas, didn't I?
No.
Yes, I was on Highway 10 in the middle of nowhere, Texas. I'm with Kristen. We're in the SUV. We're driving. To the right of me, you can see this gray, it just looks like a miniature one-person jet is what it looks like, okay? It has no markings on it, nothing. And Kristen's like, "Whoa, what's that?" I'm like, "You see that?" She goes, "Yeah." And it stays with us for a second, and you can't hear it. It's totally silent. We're going about 85 on the freeway because the speed limit's 80 or 85. We're cruising on the freeway. It keeps up with us. It's not even 100 feet up to us. And then it goes just a little bit in front of us. It turns to the left, and it goes boom, and it just blasts off. Like, it was just incredible. Totally silent, no markings. I looked it up for several weeks to find out what it was, and I looked up all these different drones. It wasn't a drone. It was a Lockheed Martin surface-to-air missile.
Wow.
So the technology is definitely there. So, I mean, don't get me wrong. The problem is, you guys, is with all the technology that's available, if this system continues to be imbalanced, it's going to get to a point to where it's going to start eating itself.
It's already happening. That's why I'm predicting depression, and I'm predicting whatever else is coming. All right, Tony, finish, and then you jump in, Troy.
Yeah, no, I think, listen, I love Rex's idea and thought process. Unfortunately, I don't think there's enough people that could afford to ever do that. There's some of us, there's a handful, probably. I know I could probably jump off the grid. Jay, I know you could probably do it as well. It's a great idea. I really have thought about going to South Africa and seeing what Tellinger has going on, because I think that the thought process behind it is great. Unfortunately, I think reality is it's going to take something of a cataclysmic event for people to really wake up and revolt and say enough is enough, to turn against the banks that are controlling us in this money market that we're stuck in. We're stuck in that money, the whole money machine. There's no way of breaking out of it. We could eradicate poverty. We could start using clean energy. They want to preach to us. They're doing all these positive things for us, but they're going in a complete opposite direction, no matter what is told or spewed to us. You know, they go to this tease that they're going to start using more forms of, you know, you're going to see more coal, even though it's clean coal that's being pushed to us. Yeah. We're stuck. We're stuck in a system. It's going to take something of major impact for us.
But you're saying we need a cataclysm. All right, Troy, final words.
Same thing. Every system that I look back at, they all need a reset. And I think that's exactly what's going to happen. Time frame, I had to put it on there because I know everybody's thinking the same thing we are. I'll say within a year, within a 3,365 days, we're going to have more than one cataclysmic event. I think it's going to be financial. I think it's going to be environmental. I think there's going to be benevolent beings helping us. That's going to be disclosure. We have alien disclosure at the end of this year, according to some. So we have all these different major, major events that are all happening at once. And at the end of the day, one just really has to ask themselves, how do I feel? How do I feel? Because that's really going to tell you. This conversation that we've been having all night, if you get right back down to the nut and bolts of it all, on every little aspect, you just have to go back to how do you feel about it. And it's funny because Rex went on that whole tangent just a minute ago, and at the very end, almost anti-defended himself, if I may, because he went right back and said, maybe that is what it'll take. Well, that's the point I'm trying to make. And that's the part that the discernment comes in. You got to get good at reading between the lines. He said it himself. I'm practicing that. I've been doing it hard for this past year. I got a long way to go, but I'm getting really good at it. You get good at discerning those kinds of things. He did right at the very end. And I picked up on that. And that's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. We all feel it. You can feel it in the air. Trust that. I don't want to be pessimistic. I don't. I wasn't raised that way. Far from it. But I'm a realist. And I'm with Tony. I'm with Jay, to a degree, with Rex as well, obviously. I don't want to be a pessimist, but I am a realist. And it don't feel good.
Let me jump in real quick if I can before we close out. This was a really nice gesture, a beautiful piece right here. At Decoders of Truth. Awesome. And you should definitely check out Facebook page at the See Beyond the Veil Art. Nicola Zetto, just incredible. Oh,
she's awesome.
Awesome.
Well done.
So,
very nice.
Thank you.
Well, $1 million.
I'll just wrap up real quick. If you guys want to have a final say, of course, I thought the show was awesome. We definitely all challenged each other. We disagreed with each other numerous times. We were all able to be very diplomatic and we appealed to each other's better sensibilities when we didn't agree with each other. I thought it was an awesome show. I think this is going to get good traction. Hopefully, Rex, you can get it up pretty soon. Thank you again for all of you guys coming on. And Troy, dude, you were awesome.
Oh, thank you. Flattery will get you everywhere.
For the first time being on a video show and a podcast, you were poised. Your answers were amazing. You were very tactful and very, very professional and thoughtful in everything you said. And, come back again soon.
Yeah, man.
Thank you so much.
Welcome to the big leagues.
I appreciate that. I have one last thought, if I may, for all of our folks at the Decoders page.
Of course.
We all, as Jay just said, we all have these, there's so many different feelings and thoughts that are going on right now, and for all the obvious reasons. So all I would ask our fellow Decoders, and myself included, is not to think too much. We have a big problem with that in our group. I do it. Again, speaking to myself too, I'm self-regulating. We don't think so much. We got a lot of thinkers on our page, and it's not bad to think, obviously. Just don't think too much, and we're doing that. Kind of go back to more to your gut. I think it'll serve you a little bit better. It's got us to where we are right now anyway, right?
The answer lies within.
It does. And I love everybody. I really do. I'm just manifesting love. I've gotten very comfortable with the two wolves that reside within me. You know, you have the warrior and then you got the peace lover. And I'm right down the middle. I'd much rather just medicate with you and then be loving, but I'll kick the crap out of you if I have to.
That's awesome, man. Rex, final words.
There is no try and do.
We can. We'll do.
Very well.
Real quick.
Plug for Leak. Yeah, Tony, you got the final words.
I don't know. One thing I just wanted to say, you know, there are actually people that are, you know, I'm in the environmental sector. I own a fertilization and pest control company. I try to do things, you know, on the organic, you know, I try to do things right by the environment. I can tell you right now in Miami, obviously with Zika being a huge thing, this is going back to what Rex was saying, we're using pretty much predominantly, we're spending big bucks. We're using predominantly all natural products, eucalyptus oil, cedar oil, cinnamon, various chilies. We're using this as an oil and it's working. It's controlling the mosquito population. Even though they claim or they say that we're having all these Zika outbreaks, we're not doing crop dusting and doing all that stuff. The places that you see where all this microcephaly issues are going on is in Brazil. And guess what? They're dumping all kinds of stuff on them. So it goes back to what you were saying, Rex. I absolutely do believe with what you're saying. It's the insecticides and the shit that they're using. They're dropping on their own people over their water. That's what's causing this, okay? Because they're finding all these higher birth rate, you know, birth defects, and, you know, all these inconsistencies there. They're not finding it in other places that supposedly would be much more prone to high mosquito populations. So I do think that there is people out there that are doing good. I see it here. So I don't want to say that everybody is always going bad. You know, it could be easy where the government could just fly over and dump shit. And I haven't been seeing that. So there is hope for change. You know,
there is, and that's a great point. There is hope for change. And MiamiCan.com is actually, you can go see Ian. He's been at the meetings in Miami. He's actually gone there over the Zika virus, the spraying, et cetera. He said one meeting he went to, there was over 300 people there. They said, no way do we want you spraying. And one person went up there that was in the system, and basically everybody had to bow down to what she said because she knew what was best for the people. So it's just insane what they're doing. And I do want to close out the night as well with go to leakproject.com. You will get access to over 300 full-featured podcasts. And if you become a contributing member, we have an awesome section specifically for contributing members. You'll get access to the podcast commercial free, downloadable, streamable. Also, we've got some really cool new decals to check out, and all contributions definitely help Leak Project. So thank you so much for listening. And Jay, it was great to have this conversation with you. Tony, Troy, you guys are awesome, man. I love having these conversations where it's constructive. We don't just sit there and agree with everything we say. We have a, you know, it's kind of a good jive vibe, and the way that it all meshes, I think, is a lot more productive than all this, all just saying, yep, uh-huh, I agree. Oh yeah, yep, uh-huh. Oh yeah, that's right. So thanks, guys. Great, and have a fantastic day. Appreciate it.
Back at you. Appreciate it.
Huge planet discovered, tilting sun, Julian Assange mentor dead, CERN, massive electromagnetic influx, WikiLeaks infiltrated, financial collapse, insider elections, globalists, nationalists, Trump versus Hillary, WAGDOG, media manipulation, mind control, matrix, latest cutting edge news, Leak Project.
Hey guys, what is going on? It's Jay Campbell from TRT Revolution and the author of the definitive TRT manual. And I'm joined by my awesome friends, Rex Baer of the Leak Project, of course, is with us tonight. And we're joined by Tony Monticone, one of my good friends from Miami, Florida, who's been on the show a couple times now. And then we have a newbie contributor to the show tonight, but not a newbie to the Decoders of Truth at all. It's Troy Gothard. He is a super moderator for us. And Troy's an awesome dude. He's been watching all the Decoders of Truth podcasts. He's very, very aware, extremely knowledgeable, and we're awesome. We're extremely thankful to have him on the show tonight. So with that said, Troy, how are you, buddy?
I'm doing well, brother. Thanks for having me on.
Awesome, man. Well, we're glad to have you. So anyway, Rex has got a bunch of amazing topics we're going to discuss tonight. We're going to jump right into the show. We know there's a ton of people in the Decoders of Truth that are interested in watching this, so I'm going to go live probably in the next 10 minutes or so. But Rex, take it away, brother.
Great. You know, it's nice to speak with all of you guys. It's good to have a roundtable going on right now. And essentially what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn off my video so I can share the screens with you guys here. But I've got a whole bunch of data set up. I've got it all bullet pointed. We're going to go through this very fluently because we do have so many different topics that I want to discuss with you guys. So let's get started. First thing that I want to talk to you guys about is the debates that I watched all three of them. And I can't believe how well the Saturday Night Live skit was that Alec Baldwin played Trump. I mean, he played Trump better than Trump does. It's just amazing. And then you watch that third debate, and I almost thought that the same person that wrote the script for Saturday Night Live was the debate writer for Trump. I mean, and just his mannerisms and everything. But there's a lot more to the information we're going to bring out right now. But I did find it fascinating how first there's this scandal about how Hillary's using these ridiculous hand signals to persuade, you know, the debates and what they're doing. And then, well, all after that, they start talking about WikiLeaks, and the mainstream media starts talking about WikiLeaks. And one thing that Assange came out with before this WikiLeaks being blasted all over the internet is, I'm going to bring information out about Hillary that's going to take her down, essentially. And now I haven't heard really anything of Assange except for some cryptic stuff. And then you find out his mentor dies recently. This just happened a few days ago, Gavin MacFayden. And if you look at the Wikipedia website itself and just the stuff that they're talking about, it's all over the news, the media, it's in the social media. I think that WikiLeaks has been taken over. I think it's a part of the establishment. What are your guys' thoughts?
I have to agree. You know, Tony, I'm going to let Tony speak here and then obviously jump in, Troy, because Tony is a very big Wiki guy, and he's been reading all the stuff, and he spends probably, you know, an hour a day going through the stuff, especially the new stuff that comes out. So he'll probably be able to add a lot more. But all I can go by, Rex, is, you know, back to what you were saying too with the Trump, you know, speechwriter, you know, writing for Alec Baldwin. I mean, I think at this point, all of us know that this is a giant three-card Monty game. You know, the elites, you know, there's obviously factions of elites. You know, some of them represent Hillary, some of them represent Trump. It's obvious. I at this point, you know, for any of us to sit here and think that whoever wins, there's going to be real change in America, I can't see it. What are your thoughts, Tony?
It's hard to say, man. Every minute, it seems like something, a different spin comes out. Everything is constantly changing. It's such a fluid environment. It's almost like you don't know what to believe anymore. It's just a level of craziness that I personally have never seen. I mean, I don't know. What are your guys' thoughts? Have you ever seen anything remotely close to what is taking place right now, especially when it comes to, you know, the politics in general, where you have?
No, it hadn't. You know, I'm 48. I'll be 49 next month. And one thing I've always followed a lot is politics. And this cycle with the Rothschilds, you know, running the cabal and having their fingers entwined into the whole political process has been a real eye-opening experience, and especially to see this time around how they go about it. And this time they went about it using the superdelegates one way, messing with the DNC and Debbie Wasserman Schultz another way. So it's really cool to see it from an awakened point of view, how the cabal is being intertwined. However, it's a sensory overload, and we'll get into that, I'm sure.
Yeah, let me jump in real quick, because when I first started talking about the elections and Trump on one side, Hillary on the other, I was thinking they were more working for the same team. Like they were actually talking behind the scenes and, okay, you do this for me, I'll do this for you. You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. No, I'm not going to make presidency, but I don't want presidency. I just want these corporate gains. I want these businesses to excel. I want this type of advertising, these connections, et cetera. So I'll play the opposite. If you've seen the video footage before they went at it into the limelight, they were friends. They were always hanging out together. There's plenty of footage you can see where Trump would come out and say, oh, Hillary, she's amazing. I hang out with the Clintons all the time. They're just wonderful people. And now they won't even walk past each other after the debates. But maybe there are two different teams working for the same league. That's what I see it as now. And I do see there being a difference. If Hillary makes it in, I think it's going to be more of the same. It's going to be a continuation of the current administration.
Right.
If Trump makes it in, I do see it being more of a nationalist type environment or archetype, at least during his administration. Now, I'm not voting for either of them. Yeah. I think that there's plenty of candidates out there that could do a much better job. But hey, you know, I mean, Trump does have a whole bunch of business savvy, et cetera. And yeah, wow, that'd be unbelievable. That would be a very interesting time. But my point is, what'd you say?
Only if I'm your vice presidential running mate.
Hello, hello. Hey, you have seen the new Kiefer Sutherland TV series out there, Designated Survivor.
I haven't seen that. I've seen the commercials for it, but I haven't seen the episode.
Well, if you guys believe in the pre-programming TV shows, media, et cetera, often portrays, in Designated Survivor series, the entire cabinet gets wiped out. I mean, the entire administration, except for two people, are left over. And that's why Kiefer Sutherland gets into the presidency, because everybody else got taken out. And then there's this, you know, it's, I'm on like episode four or something like that. But it is interesting to see a lot of the TV shows out there in media that's portraying the downfall of Western civilization, like White House down, London down.
Well, I mean, if you remember on the last podcast, you know, you intimated about, you know, China becoming the next big superpower and how Hollywood is already engineering that. So I think that slowly but surely the United States is going to lose its quote unquote luster as the world's preeminent superpower.
I think that it's heading there already. And I think that's part in place of what we're seeing going on behind the scenes, especially. I mean, if you look at the different trade pacts that are out there, you have the five, what makes up BRICS, which is Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Those have been the world's leading emerging markets, okay? They have their trade pact and plan, which is BRICS, obviously. Those five countries alone make up for 30% of the GDP. China is so far superior, especially from a financial standpoint, the United States will never, ever be able to catch back up. And then you look at Russia and where they're at, just from a military standpoint. I mean, people are underestimating what their nuclear program is at right now. Some people believe it's stronger than what we have, okay? So there's a lot going on just in that alone. I mean, if you have...
Go ahead, Rex.
No, I mean, when you're done, I'll jump in, Tony. I just wanted to bring up the new weapon systems. I was thinking about the nuclear stuff today, and I did some research into the electromagnetic weapons that they're working on right now. And we'll get into this in a minute, but they've got some new weapon technologies that are so far above and beyond nuclear stuff that I think that's quite primitive, but... Please finish what you're going
to
say.
No, it is. You're absolutely right. I mean, in EMF, some of what you're going to allude to, I mean, they can fry the electrical components of anything. So even if you have a nuke, you can, you know, fry, or if you have planes flying over that are going to come to war, you can fry everything from the machine without even having to, you know, to fire anything off at somebody. I mean, that level of warfare, I mean, wow, can you even imagine what that brings to the table? I mean, it's just a whole nother element. So there's so many variables here, but you know, if you look at the big picture, I'm still, again, you know, I say one thing and I think one thing, and then the next minute I see something else, and it's like, what's going on? But yesterday, I don't know if you guys heard or not, but they, you know, it got leaked that, you know, this whole tax plan with, you know, with Hillary Clinton, she has a tax cut for overseas corporations, huge tax slash that's been failed to be, you know, brought up or spoken about during this election. So it goes against everything that is being preached that, oh, this is a good deal for the rich. No, I mean, for the poor, that we're going to tax the rich. They're not really taxing the elites. That's the difference. The people that are going to be, the top five percenters might be paying, very well be paying a lot more in taxes. And, you know, obviously when you start looking into the death tax and all the implications that it has on the estate tax, I mean, there's huge implications there that she wants to implement. But really what it's doing is for the top 0.001 percenters that are out there, the global elite, this little tax provision that she does absolutely benefits these businesses and the banks. And it sets up for, if indeed her true idea is this global hemisphere where you have, you know, basically any corporation can pick up, move to any country within the trade pact, set up shop, pay them whatever they want. You know, these people, they can bring them from Singapore, pay them 2 cents an hour, and we can't say anything. And people think that the lower class and the middle class are going to get better from this. There's nothing good that comes from
this. There is no middle class in the United States.
But all this does to me is just prove more suppression, not just from the middle and lower class. It's also weakening even the upper class. Okay. So that it's just empowering even more so the elite. I mean, that's the way I'm taking so far.
You're going to talk about the six companies that own all the media, correct?
Right. And what you're saying, Tony, as far as these new laws and bills and tax breaks, et cetera, I mean, it's just more of the same. And it's going to go on either way. This kind of stuff people don't really care about. You'll hear them say that they do, but is it really going to change the elections? No, absolutely not. I mean, with as much stuff that's already out there to sway somebody, if they don't care after they look at all that and they just continue to vote and say, oh, well, I've got to be a part of this system anyways. Otherwise, I don't have a right to speak my mind if I don't vote. I think that's one of the most interesting mindsets. I don't want to talk down to that, but I do see that as kind of a primitive way to look at things. If you're voting for a corrupt system just because you think one person is the lesser of two evils, hey, that's totally fine. Or maybe you can go out and look for other opportunities, like being that person that you would vote for, you know, be that change. But essentially, I think that's really what it's going to take to change the system is enough people are going to have to say, look, I've had enough. You're giving me two options. I'm not going to choose either of these options. I'm going to make my own option. I mean, this is just retarded. People live in this. People are so brainwashed because of the programming that's out there. For example, what we're talking about right now, there's six corporations that control over 90% of the media. And who controls that media? Well, offshore factions, very rich, intelligent people that want to persuade you in certain ways for their best interests. Now, there's a lot of offshore factions as well. There's a lot of alphabet agencies that are orchestrated within these programming institutions. And you look at these six organizations right here, the top six organizations that control over 90% of the media. You've got Comcast, the Walt Disney Channel, or not the Walt Disney Channel, the Walt Disney Company, 21st Century Fox, Time Warner, CBS Corporation, and Viacom. Look at the billions and billions and billions of dollars that they have access to and the funds that they're bringing in. Now, if you don't think, I mean, look at the names here. There's one thing that I want to bring up to you guys. Think about this for a minute. ABC, CBS, NBC, Google changed their name to Alphabet.
Right. Now,
what does that mean to you guys? What's the first thing that comes to your mind? Alphabet agency? Why do all these companies have specific alphabet-like names? Is there something subliminal to that? Is there something more to that? Did one institution pick CBS and these other guys over there like, well, hey, that's working for them, so I'm going to pick ABC? Maybe. Now, once you find out that these six corporations control over 90% of the media, and then you've got a debate where the moderator comes out and says, well, what about WikiLeaks when they said this? You can darn well be certain that WikiLeaks is going to be in on it to that level. Now, could the moderator, could the people that are controlling WikiLeaks be in on the system now? Could they be underneath the umbrella of the execs or somebody in specific within these six institutions? I think so. Now, can I prove that without a shadow of a doubt? No, absolutely not. But this is more wag the dog, in my opinion. Kind of like when Trump, people are going, oh my gosh, man, Trump isn't putting any money out there in the media. And look at all this coverage and everybody loves him. Well, the media was giving him the coverage. They were giving him free coverage by exposing that. And they had an agenda. They always do. So if you really think that they tell you something on the media about WikiLeaks, then you do some more research into it, you might find out that rabbit hole is a lot deeper than you think. Now, that brings me to the next level of the conversation. And this is some pretty deep stuff right now. If you type into Google, tilt of sun traced to undiscovered planet, there are multiple websites, mainstream news articles, channels, and institutions that are talking about this, like Caltech. Now, if you go to Space Daily, that is not a conspiracy website. Curious tilt of the sun traced to undiscovered planet. If you want to go to Astronomy Now online, hunt for Planet 9 reveals extremely distant solar system objects. There's a lot of information out there now pointing to some very serious changes around not only our planet here at home, but also the objects in our solar system due to possibly what could be a ginormous planet. Now, let's think about this for a second. You guys have heard of Mr. Brown, astronomer Brown. He's the guy that downgraded Pluto in 2006. He's also one of the same key players that's saying Planet 9 is here and it's causing mass havoc to the solar system. So could there be something more to it? Could they have downgraded Pluto in order to, when they start talking about this extra planet causing damage, they can't leak it to Planet 10 or Planet X to keep down mass hysteria? Could this be legit, or could this be more wag the dog election stuff?
Well, I mean, again, if we're going to go by Gerald Clark or Zechariah Sitchin or, you know, Harrington and all these people that decoded this,